Two teams with contrasting styles collide in the Class 1A title game. South Beloit, with a great passing game and very little postseason history, takes on El Paso with a great running game and a long playoff history. Neither has won a state championship. One will, next on the IHSA Television Network. Welcome back to Memorial Stadium on Championship Weekend here in Champaign as we are standing by for El Paso and South Beloit in the Class 1A State Championship game. Aledo has already won a very thrilling overtime game in the 2A Championship. Let's hope for another thriller here in the Class 1A game. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kurt Pegler. El Paso unbeaten with a great running game. Derek Hunsinger has nearly 2,000 yards rushing against South Beloit, a team that wants to throw the football. Jared Shipley has passed for nearly 3,000 yards. You couldn't have two more contrasting styles. We'll keep tabs on things here from the sidelines, but now let's go up to our broadcast team, who will call this afternoon's game between El Paso and South Beloit, Jim Spencer and Steve Mays.
All right, thank you, Kurt Pegler, and he hit it right on the head. This is a game of contrasting styles. We had a great first game, Steve, and we look to have a thrilling second game as well.
We really do. You know, both these teams coming into this game averaging over 40 points a game, Jim. One team likes to run the ball, the other team likes to throw the football. So contrasting styles, as Kurt said, and I'm really looking forward to it. Two real good teams.
Yeah, exactly. The passing of Jared Shipley and the running of Derek Hunsinger. And let's take a look at how these two teams got here to this state title game. Their first state title games ever. First of all, for El Paso, they had a tough game against Cerro Gordo. They lost their starting quarterback, so we'll have to see how they handle that here in the ball game today with a backup quarterback going. South Beloit steamrolled their way to this title game. They defeated Kewanee Weathersfield in the semifinals, last year's 1A state champ, a team that South Beloit lost to in the second round of the playoffs last year.
That's exactly right. You look at that, you see a lot of points scored, but you also see a lot of points given up. So it should make for a very interesting game.
Let's take a look at some of the key players that'll be involved in this ball game this afternoon here from Memorial Stadium in Champaign. First of all, for El Paso, there you see Derek Hunsinger.
Boy, he's their all everything. You look at those offensive stats, but he's their defensive leader as well. Comes in with well over 100 tackles a game for the season, and really he is just the emotional leader for the El Paso Comets.
And he is going to get lots of carries today. And on defense, it's Kyle Feaster.
Yeah, he's going to have to not so much stop the run tonight, but he's going to have to get after the passer.
And then looking at things for South Beloit, there's the man, the all-everything quarterback, one of the most prolific passers in Illinois state history this year, Jared Shipley.
Boy, it's amazing. We looked at those numbers, and it's incredible what he's done. 41 touchdowns, only 11 interceptions. You throw that much, you would expect a lot more interceptions, but he's had a fantastic year.
And on defense, there's linebacker Jason Goldsworthy.
That's exactly right. We talk about Hunsinger on the other side. He's their emotional leader right there. Fantastic player, really runs to the football well.
All right, now let's meet the starting lineups for this ball game between the Sobos and the Comets. Let's send it to Memorial Stadium public address announcer Jeff Ritson.
Ladies and gentlemen, here are the starting lineups for the Class 1A state championship. First on defense for South Beloit. At in, number 57, James Williams. At end, number 65, David Bennington. At tackle, number 68, Justin Staver. At tackle, number 55, Rich Rowlett. At linebacker, number 22, Chris Jones. At linebacker, number 44, Brian Little. At linebacker, number 32, Jason Goldsworthy. At linebacker, number 52, Brad Baker. At cornerback, number 15, Dewan Listenby. At cornerback, number 24, Jazz Listenby. And at safety, number 12, Corey McCluskey. South Beloit is coached by Drew Potoff. At fullback, number 30, Derek Hunsinger. At back, number 17, Matt Fogel. At wing back, number 16, Joe Petta. Number 36. Number 88, Chris Carr. At tackle, number 55, Ian McWilliams. At tackle, number 59, Andrew Gilliland. At guard, number 67, Isaac Schmidt. At guard, number 52, Mike Duncan. At center, number 56, Kyle Feaster. And at end, number 40, Ryan Matsky.
Take a look at some of this, some of the keys to this ball game, this championship game in Class 1A between El Paso and South Beloit. First of all, Steve, for El Paso.
Obviously, we talked about feed the fullback. They've got to give it to Hunzinger a bunch, and you expect him to carry the ball about 30, 35 times. Goes right along with that, Jim, that you got to control the clock. They cannot keep turning the ball over or giving the ball back to South Beloit. And the other thing that we put in there, knowing that South Beloit's going to throw a lot, Jim, they're going to have to get to the quarterback, no doubt about it.
And then looking at things on the other side of the ball for the Sobos from South Beloit.
Yeah, ride the ship, Jared Shipley. You know, they're gonna, he's gonna be involved in that offense at about every single play. They're gonna throw it a lot against the El Paso Comets. Also, you gotta limit their turnovers. They turn it over quite a few times. And the other thing for a defensive key right there, force three and outs.
And get your offense back on the field as soon as possible. It's going to be fun to watch the South Beloit offense. They'll go with five wide receivers and a shotgun offense every play, very similar to what Riverside Brookfield runs with legendary coach Otto Zeman, and we'll talk about that as the game progresses. But South Beloit is going to go on defense first. We'll get to watch Derek Hunzinger lead this Comet offense against the South Beloit defense here on an absolutely beautiful Saturday afternoon, rather Friday afternoon. It feels like a Saturday at
really
Memorial
does.
Stadium in Champaign. This will be a lot of fun. We had a great first game with Alito rallying, scoring 18 points in the fourth quarter to come back and knock off Carthage in overtime in the first game, 41-40. And this game has potential to be quite high scoring as well.
It really does. We mentioned in the pregame that both teams come in scoring well over 40 points a game. They like to get after it offensively, so I would expect some fireworks from both offenses.
And we're just about set and ready for the opening kickoff. There you see Drew Potthoff, the head coach for South Beloit. In 1999, South Beloit went 0-9. And here in 2002, they're playing for a state championship. So we're set and ready here at Memorial Stadium in Champaign for the Class 1A title game. Jacob Dunkel with a kickoff. It is deep. It's taken at about the 2-yard line. And the return man for El Paso spins out across the 20 to about the 22. And that was Chris Carr on the return for the Comets. And they will take over first and 10 after that 21-yard kickoff return for Chris Carr, the senior.
That's exactly right. We're going to watch here El Paso first get the football. You're going to see a double wing formation. Hunzinger will be in that backfield all by himself. Look for a lot of misdirection.
Isaac Hill starting at quarterback. This is the first action he has seen at quarterback ever. So it'll be interesting to see how he handles things here. There you see Hunzinger in there at fullback. And it's a run straight up the middle and out to about the 25-yard line. The big guy, Derek Hunzinger, 1,925 yards rushing coming in for the senior. And taking a look at the state of Illinois map to get an idea of where El Paso and South Beloit come from. But we'll get to that a little bit later on. We'll come up and we'll have this second down and six play momentarily. First drive of the ball game for the Comets of El Paso under coach Mike Serrata. There's that standard double wing formation. Hill the quarterback under center. And again, Hunsiger, we're going to see a lot of that here in the ball game this afternoon. Gets a tough couple of yards up the middle to bring up a third down and about four for the Comets.
That's right. Get used to seeing that football play. I went up and saw El Paso play against Gordo in that semifinal game, and that's the only play they ran the whole fourth quarter with Jesse White and Sigler going out at quarterback. They're just going to turn around and hand it to Hunsiger.
Time of possession will be a stat we'll want to watch all game long, because El Paso wants a lot of it to keep Jared Shipley and that high-powered Sobo offense off the field. Here a big third down and four, first third down opportunity of the ball game. They're going to run a sweep to the near side, and it's not going to get a first down. Wrestled down from behind, but did a penalty flag come in? We could have had a face mask on the play. Joe Petta was the ball carrier for the Comets, and there was a penalty flag on the play, and we're thinking it's going to be a face mask.
Looked like face mask, definitely. Get a call here from the official.
And looking at the officials for the ball game tonight, rather this afternoon, this crew near the Springfield area led by referee John McAvoy Jr. And kudos to them. They earned their way to be involved in this game as officials, and we know they're going to do a great job here today.
That's right. That's not an easy job to do all year. You're graded.
Face mask, 15-yard penalty. Reinforced from the end of the run. First down.
And that is one of the big face masking penalties. And it'll give El Paso a first down on their first drive of the game. They have the ball at their own 41-yard line, and here they charge up to the line of scrimmage. Hill, the quarterback, under center. Fogle and Petta are the wings along with the, and there's a fumbled snap. We thought this could be a problem with Hill in there at quarterback, and let's see who came up with it.
Second down, looked like El Paso came up with that. That's the one thing that you and I were talking about. I can't believe, as I mentioned, I went to that Cerro Gordo game. I didn't see one missed center quarterback exchange. It's pretty amazing. But now here, about the fifth play of the game, we already have one, Jim.
El Paso lost starting quarterback Jesse Smith in that Cerro Gordo semifinal. He broke his arm. And backup quarterback Kyle Sigler, he's hurt as well. So they're down to Isaac Hill, who's normally a wingback. And Hunsiger bowls his way up the middle to about the 45-yard line. And a third down call up coming for the Comets momentarily.
That's going to be a tough play to run there on South Beloit. That little trap, Jason Goldsworthy, number 32. You got a little help from Adam Baker. They have very physical linebacker, does South Beloit. You see their front five right there. They play basic 5-2. It looks like they're playing here against this double wing, Jim. Base defense, they like to play as 40. But you can see they got a true nose guard there. They're playing a little 50 here this afternoon.
Third down and seven. On some counter action, they give it to Petta, trying to get around the right side. He's dropped, and we have another penalty flag on the play. Let's see what the call is going to be. We'll hear from John McAvoy Jr. here again momentarily. It was third down and seven. Let's see what the penalty does to things here. Once again, we're going to see face masking called on South Beloit.
But it really benefited from that twice on third and long. We're going to chance to see this here on a replay. See if we can catch the end of the play where the face mask happens. This is Petta there, a little inside handoff. Yeah, you see it right there at the end of the play. Number 57, James Williams, grabs the face mask.
5-yard penalty being forced from the end of the run. Replay, third down.
Well, that makes a big difference. You go from third and seven to third and two. Now it's more likely that you're just going to see Derek Hunsiger taking the ball right up the middle.
You know, I feel real confident saying that name all night. If we want to guess who's going to carry the ball, let's just say Hunsiger is. He's a fantastic back, no doubt about it.
There you see Mike Serrata, the head coach of El Paso. There you see we're just 3 minutes into the first quarter of this 1A state championship game. Right at midfield, third down and short here for the Comets from El Paso. Hill takes, it's Hunsiger. First down and more, breaking tackles inside the 40, down to the 37-yard line, 13 yards and a first down for Derek Hunsiger.
Boy, great offensive line surge there by number 56, this guy that we talked about, Kyle Feaster. Also number 52, Mike Duncan. We're gonna see the replay. Watch the offensive line surge here, Jim, as we get a good end zone shot right there. As Goldsworthy, they really seal him off on the inside, and look at Hunsiger getting upfield.
So the Comets back up to the line of scrimmage. They've penetrated to the South Beloit 37-yard line. Again, Hunsinger, left tackle inside the 30, down to about the 27-yard line. That's around 8 yards for Mr. Hunsinger. And South Beloit, the defense being pushed back a little bit. And El Paso has eaten almost 4 minutes of this first quarter clock already on their first drive.
That's right. El Paso's offensive line prides themselves. They're not very big, but they're very quick and very strong. They like to get off the football. We're seeing a lot of that here early in the first quarter.
Exactly where El Paso wants to be, second down and short. They have the ball at the 28 is where they mark it. And a give up the middle again. It's Hunsinger, I believe, with a carry. And he's close to the 20 before he is pushed down. It's going to be another El Paso first down. And it looks like El Paso's starting to get a little bit of rhythm with that offense right now.
Yeah, they are. I think one of the amazing stats I saw about Derek Hunsinger as you and I prepared for this game is he's only lost 3 yards all year. I mean, I look at that. I looked at that stat about five times. That's incredible as many carries as he's had, Jim, this year.
Hunsinger with 1,925 yards rushing coming in, the best ever season at El Paso. He's also their all-time career rushing leader as well. He is quite a running back. This time they give it to Fogle off the left side and out of his wingback position, Fogle to about the 15-yard line. Second down call up coming for El Paso.
Where they wear you out with Hunsinger up the middle, and then they always like to turn and reverse and hand to either Fogle or number 16, Joe Pettit, just to keep you honest.
Fogle was the quarterback, the emergency quarterback that came in last week against Cerro Gordo in the semifinals and directed the game-winning drive. A 60-yard touchdown drive that gave El Paso a 12-10 win over Cerro Gordo. Hunsinger, this time right tackle, running room up the middle. He's bullying his way down to about the 6. It's going to be another El Paso first down. It's going to be first and goal for the Comets.
Once again, we're going to get a chance to see a replay right here. Just a simple dive, reverse pivot by the quarterback. And look at Hunsinger, both hands on the football and dragging people as he goes.
El Paso is averaging 42 points and 420 yards of total offense this season. And the offense with Isaac Hill in their quarterback looks pretty good right now. When you have a guy like Hunsinger, you're going to look pretty good as he gets another carry. And he gets to about the 4 to bring up second down and goal to go from right around that 4-yard line.
You know, the amazing thing that you see with Hunsinger is how close he stands to the quarterback. He's kind of a little guy. He's not real tall. Kind of hides back there behind that offensive line and the quarterback.
This drive for El Paso started back at their own 21-yard line. They are just inside the Sobo 5-yard line. Hunsinger has accounted for 49 yards of offense on this drive. And under center, Hill the quarterback. There you see Hunsinger. And he is going to get the carry up the middle, fighting towards the end zone, and he is going to be pushed back at around the 1-yard line. So it is going to be a third down and goal-to-go situation for El Paso.
Boy, Hunsinger got a nice block right there by number 40, Ryan Matsky. Not a big guy, 6 foot, 181 pounds of junior, but he really got off the ball knocking people backwards.
South Beloit is not a big team up front physically, but they're very strong and they're very quick. Not just in the backfield, but with their line play as well, and it's paid big dividends for them this season. Third and goal, they mark it at the 2. Hill, the quarterback, to Hunsinger, up the middle. Is he in? No. Yes, he is. Touchdown. Touchdown for El Paso. Derek Hunsinger, 2-yard run for the Comets. They strike first, a drive that takes up over half of the first quarter clock.
That's exactly right. Mike Serrata wanted to start the football game this way, and we're going to see it one more time. Just turn around, hand it to Hunsinger, and let him plow his way through. Nice block once again. Kyle Feaster and Mike Duncan there on the left side of that offensive line.
Brandon Duffy for the conversion. Jesse Smith is their normal kicker as well, but Duffy sends this one to the uprights and it's no good. Wide left. It is wide left. And we're reminding you that this IHSA broadcast is brought to you by Country Insurance and Financial Services. Real people, real answers, real quick. El Paso with a touchdown drive of 79 yards in 13 plays, eating up 6 minutes and 27 seconds of the first quarter clock. And now the high-powered South Beloit offense will get a chance.
Well, you look at those stats as well. 11 of those 13 plays were run by Derek Hunsinger, so they're not hiding anything. They're coming out, and they're going to turn around and hand it to their all-stater.
All right, so now El Paso to kick it off. Brandon Duffy will do the honors. Joe Sager is the deepest of the deep men for El Paso, standing at his 15-yard line. Squib kick taken at the 30. And on the return for South Beloit is Corey McCluskey, and he's out to about the 45 or 46-yard line before he's brought down off a 17-yard return. So we'll get to see Jared Shipley in the five wide, no huddle, throw it everywhere around the field offense that has been very, very successful all season long. South Beloit averaging 385 yards of offense and 279 yards passing behind Jared Shipley, who has thrown for 3,600 yards this year. He's throwing on the first play of the game, and it is incomplete. Intended for one of his favorite targets, that's Dunkel, and it is incomplete to bring up second down, and I think the South Beloit fans thought there might have been a little bit of pass interference there.
That's right. That's a good matchup right there. Chris Carr and Dunkel, both of them big kids. Carr goes about 6'3", Dunkel about 6'6", so we'll have to keep an eye out on that matchup.
South Beloit has the size advantage up front, as you see there. Shipley out of the shotgun again. No huddle offense. They throw down the field. It's well overthrown and incomplete. So it's a third down and a 10 call coming up for Coach Drew Potta and South Beloit. Let's see a replay of that last incompletion.
See a replay right here as the ball almost goes over quarterback Shipley's head, and he does a good job stepping up. Nice protection, but the receiver's not able to find an open seam. Now they'll have third and long, Jim.
Third down and 10. Shipley takes the snap, looking right, throwing right, and the pass is caught. Leaping grab is made by Dunkel, but it's going to be short of the first down. It only picked up about 4 yards to bring up fourth down and 6.
Surprising call there on third and long. You only ran a 4-yard route. Now it'll be, as you mentioned, fourth and 6 from the 50-yard line, be forced to make their first punt of the afternoon.
And they'll be punting with the wind, and the guy who just caught the pass, Jacob Dunkel, is the kicker, the punter. He's only punted 26 times all year, hasn't been very much used, and he's averaging just over 37 yards per kick. The kick is away, nice and high with the wind at his back, and Carr is gonna let it bounce. It's gonna roll inside the 15 and out of bounds at the 11 is where they're going to mark it. It is a 38-yard punt, no return, and El Paso will have to work with a long field on their second possession. Let's take a look at where these teams are at. In the state of Illinois, South Beloit. You don't get any further north in Illinois than South Beloit.
That's right, folks, that is in Illinois. Even it looks like it could be in Wisconsin as well.
Just a little bit north of Rockford and El Paso, just a little jaunt down Route 74 to get to Champaign for this title game.
That's right, surprising that South Beloit came over this morning. I would have thought they came down last night, but they came long bus ride, 4 hours this morning.
So here we go, Hunsiger again up the middle. Pulls the pile with him out to about the 15-yard line. Hunsiger with his 11th carry of the game already, and he's got to 53 yards. El Paso right now has 58 yards of offense, and Hunsiger has 53 of those. That's what we expected to happen.
Well, get used to seeing it. I mean, I know it's middle of the first quarter, but we're going to call that play. I don't know. It could be 35, 40 times this afternoon if he stays healthy.
Isaac Hill, the emergency quarterback in there for El Paso. Hunsinger again. Hunsinger, the reigning 100. He just continues to wrestle his way out. Gets the first down as he refused to go down. He's the reigning 171-pound state champion in Class A wrestling. He is a ton. What'd you say that he benches 315 pounds?
Right. I went out and talked to Coach Serrata Wednesday at practice, and I had heard he benched 350, 360, and Coach Serrata said, you ought to see the kid in the weight room. He really can bench that much. And when you're benching that much and you're only 171 pounds, listed as 180 here for football, that's quite impressive.
El Paso with its fifth first down of the game. They have the ball at their own 23-yard line. This time it's Petta. Trying to fool South Beloit a little bit, and it didn't fool them very much. And it is going to be, did they fumble? It is a fumble, and South Beloit has recovered, and they're going to get excellent field position at the El Paso 23-yard line. Wow.
Boy, off a late call right here. As you see Petta get the nice, clean handoff right there. Let's see the strip. Oh, we see the strip. It looked like number 32. Goldsworthy got a hand in there. As we see it one more time.
He was our defensive key player for South Beloit, and he makes a play immediately. Five wide receivers. Shipley bobbles the ball, and he is going to be sacked all the way back at the 30-yard line. Shipley has not been sacked very often this season, and South Beloit got to him there. The bobbled snap was what doomed that play from the beginning.
That's right. I think the thing the viewers will notice, look how deep Shipley is. He's 7 or 8 yards deep. Normally in a standard shotgun formation, you might see that quarterback 4 or 5 yards deep. We've seen the ball almost go over Shipley's head 2 or 3 times this afternoon already.
Shipley again out of the shotgun, looking right, throwing over the middle. It's incomplete, intended for DeJuan Listenby. And around the 20-yard line, he thought there might have been some pass interference. It's not called, and third and a bunch, but it is 4-down territory here for South Beloit inside of the El Paso 30-yard line. And South Beloit trying to take advantage of the first turnover of the game. That turnover that South Beloit forced was their 56th of the year. They're now plus 41 in turnover differential for the year.
Well, I guess you and I talk, that's why they're playing in the state championship football game. You do that, you're gonna create opportunities.
Again, a high snap. Shipley gets it, wings it down the field. It's caught! Jazz Listenby makes the catch, a little bit short of the first down, around the 16-yard line. But it's gonna be fourth down and short now for South Beloit.
We're gonna get a replay on this as Jazz Listenby's all alone out there on the outside. You're gonna see the ball once again snapped over the quarterback's head. Nice route. We're gonna see the end. Listenby does a great job coming back on that. There's the isolation on him. Hard to stop him one-on-one.
It's a pickup of 15, and it's gonna be fourth down and short. And let's see if South Beloit, they will go to their short yardage formation where they line up very, very tight. And there's almost no room between Shipley and the running backs, and they give it up the middle, and it's going to be a first down and nearly a touchdown. Was it Goldsworthy on the carry? No, it was Chris Carr on the carry. Not Chris Carr, but Justin Sager,
yes.
Who is normally one of their offensive linemen. He goes in the backfield in their short yardage plays, and he scored 9 touchdowns this year for them.
Isn't that amazing? I know when I was prepping for the game, I couldn't believe that. I don't even know what to call that formation. It's incredible how close they are to the quarterback, but it seems to work for them offensively.
They convert on a 4th and short, keep the drive alive, and now they have a 1st and goal at the El Paso 9-yard line, waning moments of the first quarter. Shipley throws, it's caught, Dunkel, down close, he dives for the touchdown. 42nd touchdown pass of the year for Jared Shipley in the 84th of his high school career.
Get a chance to see a replay right here as once again, Chip got a lot of time right there. And Dunkel, that's tough to stop a guy that size. Just did a little wheel route there on the outside, single man coverage, tough to stop him.
He needed all 6'6" of his frame to get into the end zone there on a 9-yard touchdown pass. Goldsworthy trying to run for the 2-point conversion, and he's going to be in. Jason Goldsworthy out of the tailback position on that play, takes it in for the 2-point conversion, and South Beloit, after taking advantage of an El Paso fumble, has taken an 8-6 lead here in the Class 1A state championship game.
Get a good look right there. The fans have come down from South Beloit. There's quite a few of them here in the stands. And El Paso not being that far away, they brought a great crowd as well.
And we've got more high school football action coming up here. Championship game in Class 4A at 4 o'clock. A rematch of last year's overtime win for Driscoll. And then Steve and I will be back tonight for the 3A title game between DuQuoin and Immaculate Conception. And then we've got a full day of football tomorrow, so there's still lots of action coming up here from Memorial Stadium in Champaign. Championship weekend on the IHSA television network. Great game one. So far we've had a great game two, and it's has all the makings of a very fun weekend. So now El Paso back in play. As you look at the El Paso coaching staff, it'll be Dunkel who caught the touchdown pass to kick it off with the wind at his back. We haven't talked about the wind much. It is a factor. It is blowing out of the southwest, and South Beloit playing with the wind here in the quarter. There you see the Sobo scoring drive, 5 plays, 23 yards, just a minute 44 on the drive. And here's the kick. It's a good one. It is going to be Petta at the 4. Out across the 15 to the 20, Petta the 25, and he's going to fight his way out and be wrestled down. Actually, it was a Carr and not Petta, Chris Carr on the return, and a return of 26 yards for the senior, Chris Carr. There, you see him right there.
one of the speed guys that El Paso has, no doubt about that. They don't throw to him often as they used to. And when he was a sophomore and a junior, they've asked him to go down and play a little tight end and block for us, but they like to get him in on special teams. See right there, we have a player down injury there on the kickoff.
Right down on the near sideline. One of the South Beloit players being tended to. Right around the 20-yard line, it is 8-6 in favor of South Beloit. El Paso with a 79-yard touchdown drive and a 23-yard touchdown drive after recovering a fumble for South Beloit. And the Sobos converting on their two-point try. And the injured player for South Beloit.
Like number 89, I believe.
Yeah, Ryan McGuire. He is up and off. And there you see him heading to the bench on the South Beloit sideline. And El Paso right to work on first down. Hunsinger, left tackle, moves the pile out across the 30, and dropped around the 32-yard line. Hunsinger already with his 14th carry. And we still got a minute 20 to go in the first quarter.
I was just going to point that out. It's amazing. Good look at the defense right there from South Beloit. They're pretty physical up front. Not real big. You know, they go about 5'9", 200, 5'9", 200. Both those tackles. Actually, Justin Staver, number 68, 5'6", 200. So they have some size, but they're not real tall kids.
Here you see El Paso at the line of scrimmage. And Hill trying to run out of the quarterback position. Slips a tackle in the backfield, and he's dropped all the way back at the 21-yard line. He's normally a wing back for South Beloit, or rather for El Paso, and he has carried the ball for about 515 yards this season, but that play went nowhere.
No, that's a play that I don't think is going to work very well for El Paso. It's not something they can do, get out on the outside. We're going to see a predetermined roll right here in the replay. As Isaac Hill's trying to get outside, but with all that speed that South Beloit has on the outside, it's tough to get there.
So from the 21, third down and 18 for South Beloit. They're going to run it to Hunsinger, take the safe play. And let's see if South Beloit will burn a timeout here as the clock is winding down in the first quarter, because otherwise El Paso is going to be able to run the clock out in the first quarter, then punt on fourth down with the wind. And South Beloit, they're not going to burn a timeout.
Boy, I think they could have right there, as that wind is gusting pretty hard.
And that does it for the first quarter here at Memorial Stadium in Champaign. And with South Beloit leading 8-6, let's pause for this local timeout.
South Beloit with the lead here as we start the second quarter. Ryan McGuire of South Beloit, their senior defensive end, has left and gone to the locker room. They put a sling on his elbow. They appear that they were taking a precaution about his elbow. So it's an elbow injury right now. He's in the locker room being tended to. That's Ryan McGuire, guys.
The punt from El Paso sails out of bounds along the near sideline. Thank you, Kurt Pegler. And South Beloit will get good field position at their own 45-yard line, 32-yard punt for Brandon Duffy, and no return.
Something we haven't talked a whole lot about is field position. With this wind and having a short field like South Beloit is going to have here, actually the wind will be into them. That really helps them offensively.
So far, South Beloit has been outgained 63-27. Time of possession 9:19 for El Paso, just 2:47 for South Beloit, but the Sobos have the lead. Shipley is going to run. He's their leading rusher on the season, across the 50 and into El Paso territory around the 47-yard line. We told you that he's thrown for 3,632 yards. He's also rushed for 577.
Yeah, it's amazing. He almost has 100 carries right there. That's his 93rd carry of the season. He has 8 TDs to go along with that, so he's quite busy during the football game, no doubt about that.
Now with the touchdown pass that he has thrown here already today, he has accounted throwing or running for 50 touchdowns for South Beloit this year.
See that short yardage offense right here, Jim.
And they're going to run it right up the middle to what would be the fullback in that tight formation, and he's going to be close to first down yardage around the El Paso 45-yard line. It was Justin Staver, who normally is a guard. He averages nearly 5 yards a carry. He's had a couple of carries here in the ballgame today for 56 carries this season. And as I said earlier, he scored 9 touchdowns, and we'll have a measurement here to see if Mr. Staver picked up first down yardage.
You know, I really enjoyed talking to Drew Potthoff, the head coach of South Beloit, there before the game. Really enlightened us on what he's trying to do with this football program. He's taken this this type of approach offensively and running it down through his, you know, JV team and freshman team. He really wants to stick with this system. He really believes in what Otto Zeman was doing up there at Riverside Brookfield. He did tell us that he has his redial number in his phone, that he can call Otto anytime he might need some help. So look for him to maybe call Otto and get a little help this afternoon.
There you see the five receivers and the linemen all stay in the two-point stance every play. Shipley looking to run again. He's got the 45 to the 40, dropped at the 38-yard line. Shipley showing wheels running. Shipley only 5'8", 165, and I question that 5'8". I'm not sure if he's quite that tall. But you know, he's gutsy and he's got a gun for an arm.
He really does, and that play can really hurt you. El Paso right now is dropping eight guys in pass coverage. They're only rushing three. You see they have a true nose guard, two outside ends rushing up the field hard.
Shipley throwing deep down the left side. The ball is going to be incomplete. Good coverage for El Paso. Pass intended for 24, Jazz Listenby.
Going to get a chance to see this one more time. So you're going to see a good spread. You got five receivers out here. See the replay right there at the end of the play, just a little bit underthrown.
Third down for South Beloit. Shipley out of the shotgun, rolling, and he's going to tuck it and go, looking for the corner. He's going to run out of bounds right around the first down marker at about the 34-yard line. If that's the spot, it should be a first down for South Beloit. Right on the marker where the first down stick is sitting. And they're gonna say first down for the Sobos. The nickname Sobo, of course, is a hybrid of South Beloit. Sobos, South
Beloit. Hey, I had to ask this afternoon what it meant. You know, I thought Sobo, it may have, you know, another meeting, but it just stands for South Beloit, I understand.
And now they'll bunch three receivers left and two to the bottom of your screen. Shipley looking right, throwing it off the hands of Dunkel, incomplete. Around the 30-yard line, and you don't see Dunkel do that very often. He's a very sure-handed receiver.
Exactly. You know, I got a chance, I told you, to talk to Serrata, and I asked him, what are you going to do against this offense? Are you going to rush nine and drop two, or, you know, drop nine and rush two? He said, we're just going to lock up and man underneath, put a couple deep safeties, as we're seeing as this great game progresses. You'll see two deep safeties, and it's worked pretty well so far, but I think they're going to have to get a little pressure on Jared Shipley, the quarterback.
He certainly had a lot of time to throw, and he's aided by the fact that he's 8 yards behind the line of scrimmage out of the shotgun.
Right.
Shipley throwing on second and 10. Pop line near side, Jazz Listenby leaps but can't come up with it. It is going to be third down and long here for the Sobos. Jazz Listenby is a junior. He is the younger brother of DeJuan Listenby, a senior on this team. There you see Jazz there coming back to the line of scrimmage. South Beloit will go with no huddle. Kind of call the play as they're lining up, and then they'll be ready to go.
It's all based off of the number system. When we were talking to Coach Potoff, he said, I send out a number. They all have on wristbands. All the receivers do. You can look at that. He knows what play to make.
Shipley sacked.
Feaster.
And there's our defensive player of the game for El Paso, making a defensive player of the game type play.
That's right. Kyle Feaster, number 56, comes into the game with only four quarterback sacks, but they don't see a lot of passing in the Mid-State Conference. We're going to get a chance to see this, a replay from what Jared Shipley would see as the quarterback right there. This time they are able to get a little pressure on it. They actually brought an outside linebacker and got to the quarterback.
So it looks like South Beloit will go into punt formation. It'll be Jacob Dunkel to punt it into the wind, and Chris Carr back deep for the Comets. Kick angle towards the near side. It's going to be touched. Did El Paso touch that?
Well, it sure looked like it.
It is, and it is going to be South Beloit football. It took a funny hop. It bounced off an El Paso player, and Corey McCluskey recovers the loose ball, and once again, South Beloit will have great field position off an El Paso miscue.
Yeah, we'll get a replay of this. We'll get a good view of it right there. Who is that it's hitting right? I can't really tell.
Petta.
It looks like Petta, I believe, number 16. It did bounce off his back. The punter did a good job, Jim, right there, angling the towards the sideline, tried to kick it out of bounds. Didn't hit it very well, but it did hit Petta. And now South Beloit's in business again.
They have the ball at the El Paso 21. So now two turnovers on El Paso here in the first half. And we've got a timeout on the field. Let's take a look at some information about these teams involved in this 1A state championship game here at Memorial Stadium in Champaign. There you see El Paso out of the Mid-State North Conference. El Paso has never lost a game played in that conference. They're a perfect 30-0 out of Woodford County, the largest school in Class 1A with that 273 enrollment. And then looking ahead to South Beloit in Winnebago County, right on the Illinois-Wisconsin state line. They play in the Four Rivers Conference with an enrollment of 252. The Four Rivers has an interesting way of playing non-conference games. They don't play anybody outside their conference. They actually play four teams in their conference twice.
Two times, do they really? Okay.
To make up their nine-game schedule. It's a 16 league, and South Beloit was the champion of that Four Rivers Conference. Here's the carry for McCluskey, trying to get off the left side, and he's dropped. No gain on the play, maybe a loss for Corey McCluskey. And it's gonna bring up second down and long here for the Sobos. So second down and 11, McCluskey losing a yard there. As South Beloit with a short field here, showing a little bit of their running formations, trying to cross things up a little bit, and they'll stay in this formation. I know one coach that I know, when they put big guys in the backfield, they call it the Big Daddy Bone.
That's right.
And that's kind of what South Beloit has going on. They're gonna throw out of this, looking for Dunkel. He leaps, makes the catch for the touchdown. Second touchdown of the game for Dunkel. And it is now 14-6 in favor of South Beloit.
Boy, I love the love the play call right here. Coach Potthoff drew this up. Look, he's got everybody stacked in there, 9 guys, 10 guys. He's got Dunkel out there one-on-one, 6'6". Just throw it up in the air, let him make a play as Dunkel catches his second TD pass of the afternoon.
And his sixth of the year. And they will line up in the swinging gate. You might term this for the conversion. They snap it to Shipley. He's gonna throw into the end zone, the ball tipped away and incomplete, but a penalty flag comes in. We might have pass interference. Again, the pass was intended for Jacob Dunkel. And you see Dunkel, who has now caught two touchdown passes here in the first half.
Looks like South Beloit will get another opportunity here. You're gonna get defensive pass interference in the end zone, half the distance to the goal. So now it'll have it about the yard and a half line.
We have defensive pass interference, half the distance to the goal. Replay the try.
And I would bet that they'll go to their tight formation here, and they will.
You always got to watch for Goldsworthy in this formation, number 32.
It's a give up the middle, and it's not going to get into the end zone. The two-point conversion is foiled. On the carry was Alan Clement, number 60. So it's a 14-6. South Beloit now with an 8-point lead here with 8:48 left to play. 8:48 to go here in quarter number two. Right now, we're gonna go ahead and take a break here from the IHSA Television Network. 8:48 to go in the half. And it's 14-6 in favor of South Beloit. There you see a 42-second scoring drive for South Beloit. Two plays, 21 yards, and Dunkel with his second touchdown reception of the game.
El Paso now will get an opportunity to see if they can get it moving a little bit. I would imagine they could throw it a little bit. The wind will have it to back here with 8:48 left to go in the second quarter.
Short kick taken by Hunsinger, and he has both hands on the ball as he carries out to about the 42. A pickup of 8 on the return for Derek Hunsinger. He doesn't get too many opportunities to return kicks, but does a pretty good job there. I think if you're El Paso right now and you're Coach Mike Serrato, what you don't want to do is get caught up in the frenzy that South Beloit wants you to get into. Stick to your game plan. Run the football. You're only down by one touchdown right
now. That's exactly right. They try and put you in the panic mode. They try and speed things up, and they're trying to do it right now. El Paso, I'd stay with my game plan, but you do have to mix in a little bit of passing to keep them honest.
Hunsinger bulls forward to about the 45-yard line to make it second down and 7. Time of possession right now, 9:19 for El Paso, 5:53 for South Beloit, but the Sobos have the lead on the scoreboard.
Well, they got that quick scoring offense. You can see a good look right there of Coach Mike Serrata. What a great job he's done with a 731 winning percentage. And boy, he's a real fun guy to talk to. I talked to him a couple days this week, and very excited about his football program and where it's going.
El Paso in the finals for the first time ever. They've made the playoffs 10 years in a row. And with it, Isaac Hill out of the
fumble.
And he lost the football. The ball came loose. And did South Beloit get? Yes, they did. South Beloit forces another turnover. That is the 58th turnover they have forced this year.
Isn't that amazing? You got to give a lot of that credit to the defensive coaches. They're teaching good defensive tackling schemes. And you see right here at the end of the play that they're just going to go take and rip this football out of the hands of Isaac Hill, and the ball did come loose. And once again, now in scoring position, South Beloit. Good call by the official.
So here comes Jared Shipley in the shotgun again for South Beloit. Sobo's already on top, 14-8. He's throwing, and a diving attempt is made by Dunkel. He comes up empty around the 43-yard line. It is going to be a second down here for the Sobos.
You see Dunkel right there. Everybody looking over to the sideline, looking for Coach Drew Potthoff. As you see the sweatband, good look right there of this sweatband on Dunkel's arm. We've talked about it quite a bit.
South Beloit to Coach Potthoff, he calls a number that corresponds to patterns that the receivers are going to run, and then Jared Shipley makes a read off who he thinks is open. That's as simple as that. Shipley throwing again. Near side, it's caught by Little. Inside the 30, great catch by Brian Little for a first down.
Well, it's a great play right here. You see all the receivers. We're going to get a chance to see this. We're going to see all the receivers come in this way. We're going to see the back just carry out right here. And watch Shipley just look down the field, look the free safety off, throw the ball to the outside. Good throw, good catch. And now they have another first down opportunity.
Little making the catch, his 34th reception of the year, a pickup of 19 yards, and a South Beloit first down. Again, out of the shotgun. Shipley throwing far sideline. It is going to be tipped away and intercepted.
It looks like he got it, yeah.
It's tipped up and intercepted by Isaac Hill. And it looks like El Paso is going to have the ball. They're going to have a discussion, though. The officials are talking right now. I'm not sure if this is a final decision or not. Here you see the play coming up via the replay.
Yeah, one more chance right here. We see the man-to-man coverage right here. Both these guys locked in, just run a little fade route. As Shipley doesn't throw the ball far enough. What a great catch. I don't think there's any question on whether he caught that football or not.
Now, Isaac Hill, if it stands, making up for his fumble with the interception right there for El Paso. They're not going to have great field position, but they come up with a big turnover, and they thwart the drive, we think.
See the call here by the official, Jim.
Pass. That's ineligible upfield. The pass was intercepted. First down.
So the discussion was about an ineligible man downfield for South Beloit. So El Paso with the ball at their own 2-yard line, just the 12th interception that Jared Shipley has thrown all season long, and lots of turnovers already here in the first half. 3 for El Paso, now 1 for South Beloit.
That's right. That was a great call by the official. There's so many people downfield. I don't know how you can tell who's not supposed to be, as South Beloit has all kinds of people downfield.
And Hunsinger carries to about the 4 before he's dropped.
Well, here, if you're Coach Mike Serrata in the Paso comments, you would love to put together a little 5-6 minute drive. Just take this one into the half and maybe have a chance to tie it up. Don't do anything crazy down here. Get into the half, you know, close. That's all they want to do.
There you see Drew Potthoff, the head coach for South Beloit. His winning percentage is not that great, but 19 of those 28 wins have come the last 2 years.
Right.
As he has turned this program around. Hill looked like it might have been a busted play, and he is in trouble. He goes down around the 1-yard line, and it's going to be 3rd and long in a dangerous situation for El Paso, deep inside of their own territory.
Good call on that one, Jim. No doubt a broken play, as Isaac Hill is the only one that turned out to the left-hand side of the offense. All 3 backs go the other way. That's a quarterback's fault.
Yeah, Chris Jones, you saw number 22, just making the play moments ago. 3rd down and 10, a long 9, actually, for El Paso. Deep inside of their own territory. Hunsiger with the carry, bowling his way forward. He's going to get the first down as he just continues to chug forward, and a late penalty flag comes in as well. Hunsinger on the carry, and let's check the flag, and we might see another face mask here, Steve.
Had two of them this afternoon already. Let's get a chance to see what the call is.
We have incidental face mask, 5-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
Get a look at the play one more time from the end zone camera. What a great angle to see what Hunsinger has to look at as he's just dragging people. You see him dragging number 65, David Bennington. Bennington goes 6'2", 225, but Hunsinger with that leg strength just able to drag him for an extra 5 or 6 yards.
Hunsinger already with 87 yards rushing in the first half. He gets another carry and he's out across the 25 to around the 26. Second down coming up. There's 5:55 left to go in the second quarter here at Memorial Stadium in Champaign. The Class 2A state champion already crowned, Carthage, in an overtime thriller, knocking off Aledo 41-40. And here in game two, the 1A title game, South Beloit leading El Paso 14-6. Second down and 6 for the Comets. They'll go with an I formation look this time. Second back through the hole. That's Petta carrying out near first down yardage around the 32-yard line.
That's a formation you'll see just a little bit. When I went to the semifinal game and saw him play Saragordo, they'll take Chris Carr, who they've moved into tight end, split him out a little bit. They tend to throw out of that formation more than run really right there. You put it in the I. That time they went to Joe Petta. Had a nice little gain. As now it'll be third and short.
Third down and right around 1 yard to go. As Isaac Hill, the quarterback, ducks in. Double wing formation this time. Hunsinger, first down and more, all the way to the 41-yard line. It is a first down for the Comets, their 7th of the game.
Hunsinger, the ball carrier, down by 17, Joe.
We move under. Go ahead, Steve.
Can't talk enough about the offensive line there for El Paso, really getting off the football. South Beloit does a real unique defensive stand right there on short down yards. They take their linebacker, Brad Baker, who's a linebacker, and put him down in his stance even from that linebacker position. And it's hard to find him, hard to block him, but El Paso did a good job right there. You see it once again here.
Hunsinger off right tackle, out near midfield before he's dropped down. Hunsinger now over 100 yards rushing in the game and over 2,000 yards rushing for the season.
It's amazing. We could talk about him on every play, but I know he's just sick of talking about himself because everybody all week was asking him about it. He kept deferring everything to the offensive line. I couldn't do any of this without my offensive line, and that's a sign of a good back.
So second down and 3. Hunsinger, not the feature back. They fake to Hunsinger, and they give it to Petta, or correction, on the hill, on the fake, it was Isaac Hill with the carry around the right side.
Well, I keep looking in the program seeing Isaac Hill is normally 42, but now they, for this game, they have him at 36, so it's a little bit confusing as El Paso will come up a little bit short here from our vantage point for the first down, Jim.
And it looks like they're going to have to measure. And right now, let's go down to the field where Kurt Pegler has a report for us. Kurt.
Jim, that last long run by Derek Hunsinger puts him over the 2,000-yard rushing mark for the season. He started at 1925. He's now got better than 80, as you mentioned. He was spiked on that first touchdown run early in the game. He declined to put a bandage on there. He's been sprayed on there, so he's playing with a little bit of a hole on the top of his hand, guys.
A hole in the top of his hand. Tough guy. You can tell he's a wrestler.
Without a doubt.
He shrugs that off and keeps going. They call it a first down off the measurement inside of South Beloit territory. Hunsinger, big hole. He's down around the 40 before he's brought down. 8 more yards for Derek Hunsinger.
Boy, a great block by number 59, Andrew Gilliland. Just knocked his player outside. Derek Hunsinger makes an inside cut, picks up good yardage on first down.
El Paso has run 31 plays already in the first half, and 23 of them have been Derek Hunsinger running the ball. There you see Isaac Hill, the quarterback, as he ducks under for the second down play. Hunsinger hit in the backfield and dropped for a loss, and only the 4th time all season that Hunsinger has been dropped for a loss.
That was the most amazing thing. We mentioned it earlier. I can't believe that. As many carries as he's had, he's only lost 3 yards all year. South Beloit defense went to a little bit of different scheme right there. They covered up all the offensive linemen. They had 5, 6 off defensive linemen and were able to stuff the run right there, Jim.
So a third down here. El Paso 4-for-6 on third down so far in the game. Hunsinger tries to break a tackle at the line of scrimmage. He gets forward for a couple to about the 40, but it's still not going to be enough for the first down. It's going to be fourth down in about 2 for the Comets.
Brent Baker, number 52, made a nice play for South Beloit right there. Got a nice surge, and El Paso looks like they're going to go for it here on fourth and short.
First time in the game that El Paso has gone on fourth down. They have it at the South Beloit 40-yard line. Remember, this drive started back at the 2, and now they have it at the South Beloit 40-yard line. On fourth down, it's Hunsinger trying to sweep near side. He's got the corner, he's got the first down. Wrestled down at the 36-yard line. He needed 2, got 4. It's a first down for the Comets.
Derek Hunsinger, the ball
carrier. They went to their bag of tricks right here, as you don't see Hunsinger very often go to the outside. Quick pitch right there by Isaac Hill, as Hunsinger shows he does have enough speed, maybe listed as a fullback, but has enough speed to get to the outside, picks up 4, as you mentioned, Jim, and gets the first down.
On the 13th play of that drive, El Paso converts on a fourth down. They keep the chains moving, and this drive is now over 5 minutes in length for the Comets. Hill gives it to Petta. He's got running room. Bounces to the outside at the 30. Looks to the corner to the 25. Wrestled down by McCluskey around the 20. But another El Paso first down. Good cross up there. Good play call by Mike Serrata.
It really was a great play. And the reason that South Beloit puts Corey McCluskey back there at free safety is he has the most speed on the team. Good ball fakes right here by everybody. Good line surge by the offense. And look at Petta, shows a little bit of speed, but it's so hard to run past the South Beloit defense.
Petta hasn't got on track yet in the game, but he averages over 7 yards a carry coming in. Back to Hunsinger, running room up the middle. He's going to be close to another first down before he's dropped around the South Beloit 10-yard line. Well, I'm telling you, when El Paso has not turned the ball over, they've been pretty efficient on offense.
Exactly right. The same thing that happened in the semifinal game. I went and watched Saragota, as I mentioned. They turned it over twice in the first half there, and were only able to put, you know, 6 points in the first half on the board. They got to quit turning the football over, because they have a nice offense when they don't.
It is first and goal right now. It's not first and goal. They can get a first down inside the 1. Hunsinger carries up the middle to about the 7-yard line. They can get a first down at about the 6-inch line.
Right. Looks like South Beloit, Jim, starting to do a little bit of more stunning up front. You see some of their defensive linemen crisscross and looping a little bit, trying to block the offensive line schemes for El Paso.
Down to 1:25 to play in the first half. South Beloit on a long sustained drive that started at their own 2. Now they're at the South Beloit 7. Hunsinger is going to be dropped after a short gain to bring up a third down call.
One of the stunts right there that we were talking about, that's Brad Baker from a linebacker position. They put him down in a 3-point stance, comes across, another good surge. Tough call here for El Paso on third and long.
And El Paso will now take its first timeout of the first half with 1:03 left to play before halftime. South Beloit leading 14-6 here in the Class 1A title game. But El Paso right there, they're a touchdown and a 2-point conversion away from tying the ball game up. And look at time of possession right now, Steve. 16:29 for El Paso compared to 6:28 for South Beloit.
That's right. A little bit deceiving, though. We've talked about that South Beloit, they don't like to possess the ball that long. They're trying to get in the end zone about every play. But this is a nice drive for El Paso. As you mentioned, Jim, they started on the 2-yard line. We talked about grinding the clock out. They're doing exactly that. Let's see if they can get it in the end zone.
Right now, El Paso has outgained South Beloit 152-80. But still the Comets trail, but now they've got a couple of big plays coming up. They really need to score here. Although, it's still a moral victory to, I think, eat up this much time on the clock and keep Jared Shipley and that South Beloit offense off the field.
Keep an eye out right here for Chris Carr. Wouldn't.
Out of his receiver position, they're going to give it to Petta. Petta cutting back, touchdown for El Paso. Joe Petta on some counter action scores his 14th touchdown of the year, and El Paso a 2-point conversion away from tying it up, a 98-yard touchdown drive for the Comets.
I love the play call right there. You know they're going to be looking for Hunsinger. I knew they had to do something different. They got to look for Carr. They got to look for Petta. And right there, they elect to go to Petta. Petta gets in the end zone.
And we have another timeout on the field before the conversion. And we're going to see Petta's touchdown run here momentarily. Good looking run here by Joe Petta.
A little inside scissor action right there, and Petta does a good job. A lot of times people tend to stretch that out too far. Petta just got up north and south, got into the end zone. Now El Paso down 2-14-12 will go for the two-point conversion.
Petta, the nice compliment in the running game to the bruising Derek Hunsinger. Petta 5'6", 135 pounds. But he has carried for, you know, upwards of 900 yards this year. And we told you earlier, averaging over 7 yards per carry. This El Paso team as a whole was averaging over 7 yards a carry coming in.
That's exactly right. I was doing, as we mentioned, our pregame little thing here. And every one of them over 7 yards a carry. And but that's, you know, that's typical of a team that runs the football a lot.
We just saw our schedule of upcoming games here later on today. But a big play right now here in the 1A title game. Two-point conversion for the Comets. It is going to be Hill looking, throwing into the end zone. It is going to be caught by Carr for the two-point conversion. Chris Carr making the catch, and we're tied at 14 with 59 seconds left to play in the first half.
Boy, who's the first person out on the field? Is Mike Serrata giving a high five to Isaac Hill? He didn't know how well that Isaac Hill could throw the football, but he did a great job right there of locating Chris Carr in the back of the end zone, and Carr does a great job hauling it in. He's their main go-to guy right here. Great ground level camera angle here. Is in the back right-hand corner of the end zone. Isaac Hill's gonna find Chris Carr, gets both feet down. Now we got a whole new ball game, Jim.
Now how good do you think Isaac Hill feels right now? Because he fumbled, then South Beloit scored, he gets the interception, and now he throws the two-point conversion pass to tie the game up. And I think that took a lot of pressure off Isaac Hill to throw that first pass attempt and now complete it for the two-point conversion.
That's right, because he didn't throw one last week. As a matter of fact, you know, when Jesse White got hurt last week in their game, you know, Siegler came in and he was only 1 for 2, and Matt Fogle played a little quarterback. He was 0 for 1. El Paso doesn't like to throw the football very often.
Brandon Duffy will kick it off here for El Paso. They will be kicking with the wind at their back, but be careful. There are a lot of athletes in the return area for South Beloit. There you see that impressive scoring drive for El Paso. 17 plays, 98 yards, nearly 6.5 minutes off the second quarter clock. Their two scoring drives have accumulated almost 13 minutes of possession time here in the first half.
Exactly right. I think this is a big play right here. I don't think you want to kick it deep and get it into the hands of one of those speed guys there for South Beloit. Look for something to come up a little short here on the kick.
So Duffy has it teed up at the 40. And El Paso has Matt Fogle deep at the 10. They squib it. It is DeJuan Listenby who has returned two kickoffs for touchdowns here in the playoffs, and he is going to be dropped at about the 22-yard line, and El Paso will go on defense here. South Beloit, long field to work with, but you know what? When you've got Jared Shipley, there's no such thing as a long field.
That's right, and you mentioned DeJuan Listenby right there. He hasn't touched the football other than that play this afternoon. We haven't called his name. His brother Jazz, we've called a few times, but look for DeJuan Listenby. They got to get the ball in his hands sometime this afternoon.
But remember, South Beloit is working against the wind here at Memorial Stadium in the second quarter. 14-all tie here in the 1A title game. Shipley, they have a direct snap to DeJuan Listenby, and he's got running room out across the 35 to the 39-yard line. You called it, Steve, and they get him the ball immediately.
Well, I just think they have to. He's one of their better athletes. When we talked to Coach Drew Potthoff, he said he's our man. He's a guy we like to get him the football, and right there, a huge pickup. As El Paso only rushed two guys right there, drop everybody back into coverage, and Listenby is able to pick up a huge first down.
A 16-yard run for DeJuan Listenby. He's averaging over 8 yards per carry coming in. And again, they have a short snap, to Listenby, and he's going to carry for about 8 yards. So DeJuan Listenby in the last two runs has picked up over 20 yards, and we're going to have a timeout taken by South Beloit. They will have one timeout remaining. Both teams have one timeout remaining with 29 ticks left to go here in the second quarter.
I think El Paso's happy with doing what they're doing, giving South Beloit the running play right here. They'd like to see it, keep it out of the air and keep it out of the end zone.
There you see South Beloit with their very powerful offense, nearly 47 points a game during the regular season, and against better teams in the playoffs, no problem. They're still averaging 43 points per ball game. In beating Milledgeville, Galena, Freeport, Aquin, and Kewaunee Weathersfield. The fewest amount of points that South Beloit has scored in the playoffs is 34. We're tied at 14 as we come out of the timeout. Second down and short for the Sobos. This time Shipley takes the snap, heaving it down the right side. Listenby leaps, and he almost comes up with a great catch. Isaac Hill on the coverage for the Comets.
Boy, he's all over the field this afternoon. That's a tough play to make right there, as Listenby, very athletic. Big vertical jump. There we'll get a chance to see what El Paso's done this season as well, Jim. They put a lot of points on the board as well, and have continued that winning way here in the playoffs.
South Beloit came into the game with 5,007 yards of total offense, most of it passing. El Paso came in with 5,035 yards of offense. So, you know, two very powerful offenses, but they just do it in different ways.
Exactly right. I think we're going to get a chance to see the last play right here as number 36, Isaac Hill. You see that man coverage. Listenby almost brought that down.
And really
a great athletic move, and the official takes a little hit there at the end of the play as well.
Listenby showing athleticism, even not making the play on that one. He is the younger brother of DeJuan Listenby, who had the two running plays earlier in this drive. You just saw DeJuan moments ago. Out of the timeout, 23 seconds to play. Second quarter, it's gonna be third down and two for the Sobos. Ball is at their own 48-yard line.
See the man coverage right there by El Paso, locked on in man. Got a little two, three deep zone behind him.
Shipley, lots of room to run into El Paso territory, inside the 40 to the 37-yard line. The clock will stop to move the chains. South Beloit still has one timeout left, and now they're almost to the area where they can take a couple of shots into the end zone before we get to halftime.
That's right. I think they're going to take their last timeout here of the first half, Jim.
And South Beloit will take the timeout. Both teams are now out of timeouts. There you see the score in this 1A title game. El Paso or South Beloit trying to join Aledo as a state champion in IHSA football here in the year 2002. This is the second of four games today here at Memorial Stadium. The 1, 2, 3, and 4A title games today. They'll play 5, 6, 7, and 8 tomorrow. And of course, all the games right here on the IHSA television network.
See a lot of those fans right there that came over from El Paso. As you mentioned, not a very long drive. And quite a few of them came. I drove through the town of El Paso on my way to that Cerro Gordo game. Man, I've never seen so many windows and banners hung up. It's windows painted. It's unbelievable. They really have a vocal following.
First down for South Beloit. Shipley flushed, rolling right, throwing, and Dunkel makes another catch. He slides out of bounds at the 30-yard line. It's a pickup of about 8 yards. It's going to be second down with 8 seconds left to go in the second quarter. Second down and short upcoming for the Sobos.
Well, it's obvious who the Sobos are going to look for right here, is they got to look for Jacob Dunkel. Chris Carr, defensive back for El Paso, number 88, is following him all over the football field. Wherever he goes, that's where Chris Carr goes. But look for Dunkel right here on this play.
8 seconds on the clock. Shipley takes the snap. South Beloit out of timeouts. Shipley throwing. Catch is made by DeJuan Listenby. And he fumbles the ball out of bounds at the 19-yard line. And that'll do it for the first half. The clock is at zero. The first half comes to an end. And wow, an exciting first half. El Paso with 3 turnovers. South Beloit taking advantage of a couple of those turnovers. And we're all even Steven at 14-14 as the teams go into the locker room here at halftime. And we saw a lot of what we expected here in the first half, Steve.
Well, it's exactly right. We knew that El Paso would come in and run the football, and they've done it effectively. South Beloit has thrown the ball effectively. That's why we have a tied game at 14.
All right, let's head down to the field to Kurt Pegler. He's standing by with El Paso coach Mike Serrata.
All right, Jim, we're with Mike Serrata, the head coach of the El Paso Comets. What more can you say about that long drive? It chewed up about 7 minutes and it tied the ball game there in the late in the second quarter. Big, big drive for your guys.
No doubt about it, guys. Right back in the game. I thought both our drives were outstanding. We took about 7 off the first drive, too. Our kids have handled things real well. We had a couple mistakes early in the game. I thought we rebounded real well. The score before half was huge. So, you know, hey, it's a great Class A football game, isn't it?
I know you said that you wanted to try to keep their offense off the field, Sobo's offense off the field, and you've done that with those long drives.
So far we have. If we can do it in the second half, we should be in a good position where we are right now. So anything can happen. We're going to try to control the ball like we did and try to keep them off the field.
Thanks, Mike.
You betcha. Thank you.
All right, congratulations on a good first half as they came and they tied the ball game. What a good Class A championship game. 14 all between South Beloit and El Paso. Jim?
Well,
Well, despite the three turnovers in the first half, Mike Serrata looks pretty confident and calm right now as he heads into the locker room.
You know, that's his demeanor, and that's the demeanor of the El Paso team. Not a very emotional team. They all play very quietly, and it's paid off in this first half as we have a 14-14 tie.
Halftime here in the Class 1A title game, and we're even as we're going to take a break. A local timeout here from the IHSA Television Network.
South Beloit 14. We have an entertaining second half on tap, but first we're going to meet both cheerleading squads. First we're going to start with the El Paso Comets, who rallied in the second period to tie the game. Well, you guys are all decked out in your school colors. I want to ask you about the painting, or I should say the bleaching of the guys' hairs. I know all the players bleached their hair for the playoffs. Did the cheerleaders try to do anything? Did you guys do anything for the...
My hair.
the teachers.
Do the dyeing of other people's.
I guess that's my question is, who did the dyeing? I think the cheerleaders assisted in some of that, no?
Football players did it themselves.
But there was some additives, right? There was a couple of purple streaks and things that were put in with some of the guys' hairs, right?
Yeah.
I walked around with one and did all the guys' hairs, put their numbers in the back of their head and stuff.
What has it been like at El Paso this week? It's been a lot of fun. Everybody's talking football, right?
No learning. We haven't learned anything. All we've done is talked about cheerleading.
I'm not joking.
No, I know. About football.
Right, yeah. Nobody says they've learned anything this week, but they've learned that El Paso is a pretty good football team, and the cheerleading squad is fun, too. How much fun has it been? The team has yet to be beaten all year long. Every game that you've cheered, that's been a victory. It's kind of nice to cheer when you've got a winning team, right?
Oh, correct, yeah, definitely.
It's unbelievable. They've had an awesome season this year.
Great. You guys are going to perform for us, huh? You got to cheer for us? All right. Why don't you? I'm going to step back and you guys do your thing, all right? El Paso Comets cheerleading squad. That's the El Paso Comets cheering squad. Attitude, why don't you come on in here? I know Attitude wanted to take part in the cheer here. Attitude is with the IHSA, and I know that Attitude obviously can't communicate verbally with us, but the cheerleaders, you guys have good attitude, and you like it when Attitude shows up, right? We'll be talking with Jeff Creek, hopefully momentarily, too. While we're waiting for the cheerleading squad for South Beloit, I just want to ask one more question. Now, if El Paso wins the state championship, will the cheerleading squad bleach its hair, or will you guys do something like with the football team? All right, now that we've got that on tape, we're going to bring that out next week at the Comets rally and win. Thank you for your time, ladies, and good luck in the second half. El Paso's cheerleading squad, 14-14, halftime here, the Class 1A state championship game, and we're back with more after this local break. At 14 at halftime of the Class 1A state championship game here in Champaign. And we are joined now live by Jeff Creek from the IHSA office, who is in charge of the Sportsmanship Award and some of the sportsmanship things that go on throughout the state of Illinois. Maybe you can tell us what is going on right now. I know that you guys go up and down with attitude at football games and basketball games and pep rallies, and you really stress sportsmanship.
Sure, I think sportsmanship is a key issue, and I think we saw that really big in the first game today. We have a sportsmanship committee that comes to all of our state events, and we do have a committee here at football. It's made up of athletic directors, principals, coaches, officials from throughout the state that come here, and they watch the fans, the players, the coaches, and basically they have a rating system, and they rate them based on their sportsmanship. And we saw not only a great football game in game one, but some great sportsmanship from both the fans and the players that played. And we awarded both the team sportsmanship awards, and that's something that we rate all eight games today.
When you talk about sportsmanship, what are kind of those things that you're looking for that would qualify a team as being a good sport?
Well, basically, we're looking at acceptable and unacceptable behavior. And anything I think that you would see in a classroom
is basically acceptable behavior. We want things that are positive, positive for your team and not negative against the other team. And when fans can do that, I think it makes for a better environment like we saw in game one.
And I know that it doesn't just stop with the teams, with the coaches and the players. You like to see good sportsmanship in the stands with the fans too, because it's really a trickle-down effect. If it's being done on the field, then it's going to happen in the stands too.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And you see it not only at the high school level, but all levels. You really want to see that. And we definitely stress that. And I think you saw it with the fans in game one. And it starts with the administration of the schools. If they think that sportsmanship is a key issue, they address it with their fans. And then it starts there. And the coaches address it with the players. And it's, so it's a trickle-down effect, like you said.
We've seen attitude. He was hanging out with the El Paso cheerleaders. What kind of things, I know you take attitudes to pep rallies and you take them around the state. Tell me about the importance of having a mascot that you can identify with, good sportsmanship.
Oh, sure, it's just like anything else. It's something that people see it and they automatically think good sportsmanship. And it's something that we take around. We have sportsmanship summits for students, which is a key thing that we do every year throughout the state. We also have a lot of programs for coaches that we do. And it's all dealt and based around the attitude program. And they can all go to our website and see. We have a handbook which has numerous things that the fans, the players, and the coaches can get, and it's information that they can read about. And a lot of what sportsmanship is really awareness. And we're just making people aware, making the schools aware of what we expect when they come to a high school event.
Do you find that most administrators and those involved in the school community embrace this because they want to see good sportsmanship? They want to see really good attitudes in their hallways, whether it's regarding sports or not.
Oh, absolutely. And it, like I said before, it's about education. And we're just educating the kids. And this is part of the high school experience that they have. And the educators obviously want the kids to be the best citizens they can be, and this sportsmanship is just part of it.
You've logged some miles, haven't you? I mean, there's not a corner of the state that you don't go to.
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, we get out. The attitude suit goes all throughout the state, not just during football, but throughout the entire year. And the schools love it, the kids love it, and it's something that I think is really catching on. And attitude could be at a school near you very soon.
Just check your local listings on the IHSA.org website. Jeff, thanks for the visit.
Oh, thanks.
All right, Jeff Creek, who is the IHSA man in charge of sportsmanship. I'm going to walk around this way because we've got the South Beloit cheerleaders standing by after you guys did such a nice performance at halftime. Congratulations on your halftime performance. How much work goes into a performance like that when you guys perform at halftime?
A lot.
A lot of work.
8 hours on a Saturday.
Eight hours on a Saturday putting a routine together like that, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess there's more than just football players hitting the weight rooms and doing things to get themselves ready. You guys are doing the same thing. What's it been like at South Beloit? It's a school that last year I know you were in the playoffs, but really it's a team that hasn't had much playoff experience. I imagine it's just been a buzz all year long.
Yes, it's been great.
They're so proud of themselves.
It's been amazing.
Yeah.
And now I know you guys are excited. You're going to a brand new high school. You guys didn't. We talked with your principal before the game. No school all week, so everybody could move into the new place. And now you've got a brand new high school waiting for you on Monday. What are your thoughts on that?
We can't wait to move in. We can't wait. We think it's just going to be so fun.
Yeah.
Put in there.
All right. I'm going to step back, and you guys are going to do a cheer for us for the IHSA Television Network. Go to it. The South Beloit cheerleaders, thank you ladies so much for your effort and your routine for us. It's 14-14 South Beloit and El Paso, halftime of the Class 1A state championship game. Back with more after this local break.
Welcome back to Memorial Stadium in Champaign. Jim Spencer and Steve Mays back in the broadcast booth high atop Memorial Stadium. 14-14 is your score here in the 1A state title game. Let's take a look at some of the first half statistics as we're all tied up on the scoreboard, and we see an advantage in yardage for El Paso and significantly in terms of time of possession, and that was one of our keys earlier on.
Yeah, without a doubt, no doubt about it. We knew the rushing yards would favor El Paso, but you look on the other side, the passing yards favor South Beloit. I think the big thing we need to talk about are those turnovers. That's quite a few turnovers here in the first half. You're going to have to do away with those if you want to pull away with this State 1A class championship.
Yeah, all 14 of South Beloit's points have come off of turnovers from El Paso, and there you see some more statistics on third down and on fourth down. The team's very efficient all in all.
Yeah, I thought it was very cleanly played first half. We didn't have very many penalties at all, which I thought was great. And I look for a great second half and just more of the same, really.
And let's look at some of the first half highlights here in this 14-all tie. First, we're going to see the first touchdown of the game. It's the big guy, Derek Hunsinger, right up the gut for his 32nd touchdown of the year.
Just keeps rolling along, and that offensive line, I thought, from El Paso had a nice first half. And we're going to see right here the tight end.
Dunkel.
Is that Dunkel right there going up high for his first of his two touchdown catches? He's quite a receiver. I think he could play at the next level somewhere.
And now this is Joe Petta scoring the second touchdown of the game. Some counter action. Nice cutback there by Joe Petta going into the end zone. And that tied the game at 14 near the end of the first half. And right now, let's head back down to the field. Kurt Pegler standing by once again. Drew Potthoff is the head coach of South Beloit, and he is with Kurt. Go ahead, Kurt.
Thank you, Jim. Yeah, Drew Potthoff, the head coach of the Sobos, with us. You've taken good advantage of the turnovers that El Paso has come up with, and you guys have cashed in, but their long drives have kept your potent offense off the field.
Yeah, they're keeping us off the field, so we've got to adjust. We've got to score. We've got to take care of the opportunities that they give us, and we can't afford any three and outs. So we just have to settle down, and we got rid of the jitters in the first half, so now we just got to play our style of football, and we'll be fine.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about the jitters, because it looked like there were a couple of bad snaps, and it looked like it was a little rough starting, but then Jared seemed to pick things up.
Yep. Once we get settled down, you know, this is a big deal, and a lot of excitement and things like that. We'll be all right. All we have to do is settle down and play our football game. I've got confidence in these guys. I've believed in them all the time I've been here, and they believe in themselves. So we'll be fine.
Good luck the second half.
Thanks a lot.
All right. That's the head coach of the Sobos, Drew, is with us. And I'll tell you what, his team has played very, very good football, and they've taken advantage of those three turnovers. But it's a 14-14 game, and it's really anybody's contest. Jim?
All right, thank you, Kurt. Individual numbers quickly here. Derek Hunsinger, 29 carries in the first half for 135 yards and a touchdown. Jared Shipley for South Beloit, 7 out of 16 passing with one interception, 88 yards, and a couple of touchdowns. We're all tied up 14-14 here at halftime between South Beloit and El Paso, and we will have more from Memorial Stadium in Champaign after this local timeout. Halftime, close to the start of the third quarter at Memorial Stadium in Champaign. 1A title game is halfway home, and it's all even. There you see the score, 14-14 between El Paso and South Beloit. Looking back to the keys to the game, Steve, I think we're pretty on cue with those.
I think we were pretty right on those first two, no doubt about it. But the third one there, if you look at Mike Serrata there in the background, I think he'd like to see his team get to the quarterback a little bit more here in the second half.
But to control the clock certainly was huge for El Paso in the first half with 16 minutes and 33 seconds of time of possession compared to just 7:27 for South Beloit.
Exactly.
And they certainly fed the fullback to the tune of 29 carries in the first half, Derek Hunsinger.
There you go. You see the keys to South Beloit. They ride the ship. They rode them a little bit there in the first half. They were able to limit their turnovers as well. Only had one turnover in the first half. Forced three and outs. I don't think they forced enough of them there in the first half.
They forced some turnovers, but right. They didn't force some three and outs.
Exactly.
And I can bet they're going to ride the ship a lot here in the second half. Shipley with only 88 yards passing in the first half. And we look for some more big numbers from him here in the second half, potentially. And, you know, the numbers for South Beloit a little bit jaded, right, because they got opportunities to work on short fields after turnovers. Their touchdown drives were just 21 and 23 yards after recovering El Paso fumbles. So those numbers are a little less than they would be because of the field position, the great field position that they had to work with.
That's exactly right. And I thought Shipley was a little bit nervous there in the first half. He looked like he was setting his feet real well, but he was overthrowing everybody. It seemed like, you know, that's a kind of a sign of nerves. And let's see if he settles down here in the second half as he did there late in the first half.
Derek Hunsinger is approaching a Class 1A state title game record for rushing attempts. He already has 29 in the first half. The record is 34, set by Matt Gillen of Monmouth Yorkwood back in 1983.
I'll bet you he gets it.
Yeah.
I'm going to go way out and say I think he's going to get that.
I think he's going to get
it. Take a bet on that one?
In the first 5 minutes of the third quarter. That is a record that Hunsinger might just shatter here in the third quarter.
Exactly.
But South Beloit is going to get the football first.
And remember, they will have the wind here
in
the third
quarter.
We've talked about quite a bit this afternoon.
The wind's certainly a factor. It seems to have died down a little bit since the start of the game.
Boy, it has.
Squib kick taken by one of the up men near the 40, and he's dropped as he gets to the 44. Ryan Jones on the return. There you see him right there heading to the sideline. And South Beloit, excellent field position to start the second half.
You know, they had good field position all afternoon, been able to cash in on it two times. Let's see what they go to right here, as they have four receivers now, a new formation here in the second half, four at the top of the screen there.
And they have a single receiver, Dunkel, and he's got single coverage. Have a safety leaning to his side a little bit, so there will be some help there for the corner guarding Dunkel. Shipley looking to throw, now he's gonna run. Shipley up the middle, dances out across the 45 to the 46. Short pickup on the play. It looked like he got a lot of yards, but he's so far behind the line of scrimmage, he only ended up getting two.
Exactly, I think South Beloit was looking to run a little quick screen there on the outside to number 12, Corey McCluskey. Dick Boris, who we haven't talked a lot of whole lot about, is the defensive coordinator for El Paso. I think he's done a great job preparing the El Paso defenders for this game.
It's DeWan Lissenby again on the short snap. He's into El Paso territory, a little bit short of the first down. Third and short is upcoming, and we've seen that play now three times from South Beloit. It is a good changeup to what they do normally.
It really is. A little short snap to Lissenby. He's pretty physical. He gets upfield right away. That's all they want to do, keep you honest, make those linebackers stay in there, so when they do go back to their passing game, they're not just flying out. You have to respect that pass.
DeWan with three carries for 32 yards. He gets the carry again on the short snap. He's trying to get to the near side. He's going to be pushed back, but he did get first down yardage to the 43.5 yard line, and it'll be a first down for South Beloit, their ninth of the game.
I like how Jared Shipley carries out his fake right there on the short snap. He snaps up and acts like he's going to throw the football. Try and confuse the defense as much as you can.
So first down for South Beloit. Ball is at the El Paso 44-yard line. Early third quarter action. Shipley rolls, and now he's going to run. Shipley to the 45 and gets to the 40. It's a pickup of four. Second and six upcoming for the Sobos.
You know, he's a tough kid. I mean, he takes a lot of hits during the course of a game. I mean, he'll carry that football, stick it up. He's not going to slide when he gets a chance to get near those linebackers. He's going to try and run one of them over. There you see a good look of Jared Shipley. Not a big guy, but a tough kid.
Shipley not getting very many college looks right now. None of the players on the South Beloit team, despite their athleticism, have signed to play college. And obviously Shipley's limitation is simply his size, but man, oh man, he would make some college team a heck of a player someday. Pass to the near side, incomplete. It was intended for DeWan Lissenby. He's pleading for a flag. He's not gonna get it. And we're going to have a third down call coming up.
Boy, it looked like Corey Price, defensive back for El Paso, got away with one right there. You see Corey, he's kind of shaking his head, a little smile on his face. He knows he got away with a push against Lissenby.
So third down coming up for the Sobos. With the wind, South Beloit here in the third quarter in a 14-all tie. The snap to Shipley. Jared is going to roll to the near side. Fakes the pass across the 40, 35 out of bounds at about the 32-yard line is where they're going to mark it, and it should be enough, and it will be enough for another South Beloit first down. Great job by El Paso in pass coverage, but now South Beloit moving the ball on the ground.
Yeah, it really is, but I'm telling you, this is the way Shipley kills you right here. Your defensive end's got too far upfield. Shipley gets outside of him, and he's got pretty good speed, and right there picks up a huge first down to keep this drive going.
There's been one game all season long where South Beloit has rushed for more than they've passed, and that was in the quarterfinal win over an undefeated Freeport Aquin team when Aquin sent eight guys back and Shipley just ran wild in that game. Shipley wants to throw this time. Now he's flushed out. Stops, heaves it towards the end zone for Lissenby, and it's right through his hands. Oh my. What a play by Shipley to even get the pass that far. On the run against his body, had enough to get it into the end zone.
Well, I thought he threw it a little bit late. As you see, a good look right there. Lissenby get a chance to see this one once again as Shipley puts everything he can into this, feeling some pressure. Watch the ball go right through the hands of the receiver. That one should have been caught for a touchdown.
9:49 left to go, third quarter. So now it is going to be second down and 10 for the Sobos. Ball is at the El Paso 32. There you see the empty backfield, the five wide receiver set that South Beloit uses most of the time. Shipley on a quarterback draw across the 30. He's crunched and downed at the 28-yard line. Hunsinger was one of the players that got to Shipley.
Yeah, Hunsinger comes in as their leading tackler, 142 tackles into the game. We haven't called his name at all. He's had a few chances to on Shipley on quarterback draws, but really hasn't been in the defensive package that El Paso's put together.
Shipley got four there to bring up third down and six. Shipley has rushed for 37 yards and passed for 88. Shipley wants to throw this time. He is going to pump fake and roll, and he's in trouble. And he manages to get the pass off, and it's intercepted. It is picked off by number 23, Corey Price, and that is the second interception of the game for El Paso.
Well, it looks like the reason they were able to get the interception is go back to one of our keys. We talked about getting to the quarterback. They're finally able to put a little pressure on the quarterback as they force Shipley out of the pocket right there, and he makes an ill-advised throw. The receiver really was not open. Great job by El Paso. They'll have their first series here in the second half.
The pass intended for Dewan Listenby, and second turnover of the game for South Beloit. They go with their double wing. Hunsinger will get his 30th carry of the game off left tackle, and he gets a couple of yards before being pushed back.
Just doesn't like to go down, does he?
No, he does not.
He
never went down on that play. Second down and nine upcoming. 8 minutes and 50 seconds to go third quarter in a 14 all tie. Hunsinger with 30 carries for 136 yards. The IHSA Class 1A state title record for yards in a game is 239. Hunsinger might have a chance for that as he carries out across the 30 to the 32. Again, El Paso is playing with its third string quarterback. And he's done a pretty good job. And obviously the game plan is to give the ball to Hunsinger and not make mistakes. Now, he did make one, talking about Isaac Hill, but he atoned for that by coming up with an interception a little bit later.
You're exactly right.
Third down and three for the Comets from their own 32. It's Petta, hit hard and dropped, and he's going to be short of the first down. Fourth down and a yard is upcoming for El Paso. I don't know. What do you think?
I think you're going to punt it here. We're going to get a chance to see the replay and watch the defensive surge right here. Was that Listenby, I think?
Yes,
number
it was.
15, man, what a nice hit.
Dewan Listenby.
That's right, I got to talk. There's two of those Listenbys out there, but Dewan made the play right there.
And it will be a punting situation for El Paso. Brandon Duffy, who's only punted 12 times all year, gets the kick away. Off the side of his foot, angling to the near side, the ball is going to be downed at about the 45-yard line. That's where South Beloit will take over. 21-yard punt, no return. And South Beloit, once again, with more excellent field position.
They really are playing with a very short field this afternoon, this time about the 45-yard line. We're going to see a little bit more of the same. El Paso just needs to concentrate on getting to the quarterback and putting pressure on Shipley.
I'm sure Mike Serrata is preaching to his team, okay, we're against the wind here in the third quarter. If we can hold them
exactly
with their offense, with them having the wind here in the third quarter, we're going to be in great shape in the fourth quarter. Let's see what the Subos can do here. Short snap again to Dewan Listenby. He carries forward into El Paso territory around the 49-yard line. Another good run on the short snap to Dewan Listenby. I like this offense.
This has
got to be a fun offense to teach, to play, to learn. It just gets so many kids involved in exciting ways. Folks, don't forget to the best way to find out all the information about what's going on here in Champaign and in all other sports going on in Illinois. That's, you see it right there on your screen, IHSA.org. That is the website to go to find out all that information. Here's a pass caught by Eschen. It's a pickup of 18 yards and a first down. First catch of the game, for Eschen.
Yeah, this is just a great throw. They've gone to this play. You're going to see Eschen come in here from the outside to a very deep post. And look how deep Shipley is there at quarterback. And he steps up, good time. And Eschen, two hands on the football. Good throw, good catch.
And a first down. Shipley back to work, throwing. Pass is going to be caught by Dewan Listenby. Penalty flag comes in late. That might be another face masking penalty. We've seen three already in the ballgame. We'll have to wait on the indication from the officials. Listenby making the catch.
Well, we talked about Listenby needing to be more involved in the offense. That's his fifth play here in the second half. And look what's happening to the offense. They're able to move the football a little bit better than they were in the first half.
Listonby got 13. They'll add five more on and move the ball to the 11. There you see DeJuan Listonby, the senior for South Beloit.
We had an intervening face mask on the defense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
So South Beloit first down at the 11. They can get a first down again at the 1. So they do not have to get in the end zone. Short snap, they give it to Listonby. He carries inside the 10 to about the 9. A couple of yards on the play for DeJuan. Listonby is a 5'7", 150-pound senior. Second down and 8 coming up for the Sobos. We're approaching the midway point of the third quarter. We're all tied up 14-14, but South Beloit knocking on the El Paso end zone door.
That's right. Down here, you got to watch out for Jacob Dunkel, the 6'6" receiver. He's out here down at the bottom of your screen, single man coverage.
And we've got a stoppage of play. Dunkel has already caught 2 touchdown passes in the game. Touchdown passes number 42 and 43 on the season for Jared Shipley. So now whatever.
Reset the 25-second clock. Thank you.
They're going to reset the third quarter clock to 5:58. And the play clock has been reset to 25. And now on second and 2, the Sobos go back to work. Out of the shotgun, they give it to Shipley. He throws into the end zone. It's caught by Eschen for the touchdown. South Beloit goes up 20-14.
Boy, Jared Shipley shows the strength of his arm right there. I mean, he just puts, this is a Scud missile coming in. It is just a laser beam. And Joe Petta took a little bit of a gamble there, number 16 for El Paso, wasn't able to get there. And Shipley gets his third touchdown pass of the evening.
And South Beloit up to the line of scrimmage. There you see Eschen talking to the coaching staff after his touchdown catch. They'll go with a power eye formation. And is it Goldsworthy carrying? And he's going to go in for the 2-point conversion. Jason Goldsworthy carries it in for 2. And South Beloit reclaims the lead. The Sobos lead it 22-14. Right now from Memorial Stadium in Champaign with 5:49 to play third quarter, let's take a network timeout. 5 plays, 54 yards on the touchdown drive, taking up 90 seconds. Shipley's touchdown pass to Gary Eschen. And now South Beloit puts it back in play, and they'll boot it into the end zone in high school. Automatic touchback.
Boy, a question to you, Jim, is where was Eschen in the first half? I never saw the ball thrown to him, and obviously they saw something when they went in and talked at halftime that maybe Eschen's lined up on somebody that can't handle him, and obviously that's the case as he had 2 big catches there on that drive.
Eschen now with 25 catches on the year. 2 catches for 24 yards in that scoring drive, as Steve said. So 22-14 is the lead for South Beloit. Hunsinger goes back to work with running room and close to first down yardage as he surges out to the 30-yard line. Hunsinger's 32nd carry of the game, 2 shy of the Class 1A record for carries in a game.
That's just amazing to have 29 carries. I've been involved in high school football a long time and never really seen anybody have 29 carries in 1 half. That's a lot for a game.
Isaac Hill, the quarterback, gives it to Hunsinger. Tries to cut back to the outside. He's in trouble, and he is going to be dropped for a loss. Let's see where they down him at the 21. They threw him down, actually, inside the 20. They're going to mark it at the 21. Big loss on the play. Hunsinger trying to bounce it to the outside.
Yeah, exactly right. If you can draw it up on the board, if you're a South Beloit defensive coach, this is the way you want Derek Hunsinger to have to run, east and west, not north and south. As South Beloit just has too much speed on the outside, and they drop Hunsinger for a big loss there on first down.
The only pass that El Paso has attempted in the game was on a 2-point conversion, which was successful. Now it's second down and long. Hill is going to keep it, trying to get to the near side across the 20, and he's out to the 27-yard line before he's dropped down, and pretty good run there for Isaac Hill out of the quarterback position.
Got a nice block from Matt Fogle out there. Matt's playing on a very tender ankle that we talked about at the beginning of the game, but nice block on his part. Now El Paso, what do? Do you go back and throw the football right here, third and about 12? Or do you just turn around and hand it to Hunsinger? Interesting call right here for Mike Serrata.
Working against the wind, that should factor into the decision as well. As El Paso comes up to the line of scrimmage, third down and 13. Hill takes ball loose, scramble for the ball, and I think El Paso fell on it. And they did, so it's fourth down. Hunsinger recovering the fumble. So fourth down and long, and El Paso will be forced to punt.
Boy, if you look at the flag here in the end zone, it almost looks like it's switched a little bit.
Yeah, you're right.
Now it's almost at the back of El Paso here in the last few minutes. Kind of a wind that's gusting a little bit.
If you look at the flags on top of the grandstands, it's still blowing kind of out of the southwest. The kick is away, very good punt. And Listenby will let it roll. It's going to take an El Paso bounce and be downed at the 35-yard line. It is a 39-yard punt and no return for Brandon Duffy of El Paso. 35. And the Sobos, with a 22-14 lead, will go to work with that 8-point advantage.
Yeah, and who would have thought that a lot of that would come via the run by DeJuan Listenby. You know, he's had some nice runs there from the direct snap from the center, and he lines up in that position once again. Watch for a little bit more of that here on this series.
Out of the shotgun, they start from their own 35. They snap it to Shipley. He throws near side. It's caught by Jazz Listenby. He dives to the 42-yard line, short of the first down, but second and short coming up. You gotta love that name.
Yeah,
Jazz Listenby. He's a junior. His brother DeJuan is a senior. So second down and three, upcoming for the Sobos as we reach the 3-minute mark of the third quarter. South Beloit scoring on a 9-yard touchdown pass from Jared Shipley to Gary Estgen earlier here in the third quarter. It was tied up 14-14 at halftime. Again, four receivers, and they snap to Shipley. Shipley looking to run. He dumps it back to Listenby, and he's got running room. Listenby's got a first down.
He
fumbled the football, and I think South Beloit was able to cover it up, and they did. And it remains in possession of the Sobos. That was not exactly the prettiest play in the world.
Well, do you think Coach Potthoff has that one in his playbook? I don't think this is the way you draw it up, as Shipley has all the time in the world. Right here, he almost runs into a sack himself, pitches the ball out to DeJuan Listenby. And El Paso does a nice job right there. They're going to force the football to come out. As actually Listenby just drops it. Very fortunate to get back on that football.
The ball is marked at the 49-yard line. First down for the Sobos. Shipley looking to throw. Airs that out over the middle. It is caught by DeJuan Listenby. Breaks the tackle. He's on the run up the left sideline to the 25-yard line. It is a pickup of 26 yards and a first down for the Sobos.
I can't talk enough about it. Another great throw by Shipley. As you're going to see him, they're giving him way too much time right now as Shipley steps up, all the time in the world. Look at Listenby right there, makes player miss. Nice move on the outside, and once again, they're in business here about the 24-yard line.
DeJuan has got a dangerous combination for defenders. He is fast, and he is strong.
Exactly.
So they mark the ball inside the 25, near the 24-yard line, 2:07 to play. Third quarter, South Beloit leading by a touchdown, 22-14, and they're driving for more. Now at the El Paso 24. Back to the five receiver set, and penalty flags come in. The play clock wasn't all the way down. Somebody must have moved. We'll get the word from John McAvoy Jr., our referee. They're discussing things right now.
We have a dead ball, false start on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
You know, another
reset the game clock for 2:07.
One thing that you have to make this offense work is obviously skill and athleticism, but you have to have discipline.
Oh, without a doubt.
You don't see, they throw it all the time, but South Beloit does not commit holding penalties. They haven't, that was the first time they've jumped off sides. So they're a very disciplined football team as well. Shipley looking to run. He's got a hole inside the 20. Shipley cuts back at the 15, spins around at the 10.
Fumbled.
He fumbled the ball. It's loose. And it is going to be recovered by number 52 for South Beloit, Brad Baker. A fortunate break for the Sobos right there. What a great run by Shipley, though.
Well, it really was. I mean, they have them all spread out. You can see everybody. Is nice block there by the offensive center. As Shipley just goes upfield right here, get a little careless with the football. Look at that ball hanging out. I think that might have been Chris Carr coming in from his defensive back position and pulls that ball out of there. Look at Shipley. He's got that ball hanging out there. You got to tuck that one away as El Paso can't fall on the football. And now South Beloit really in business, Jim.
First and goal at the 8. Shipley is going to run again. Shipley to the 5, and he slides down. They're going to mark him, I think, at the 6 is where he goes down. Clock rolling with 1:35 to play. Third quarter. South Beloit up 22-14. There you see Derek Hunsinger playing linebacker for El Paso.
You know, it makes it tough on Hunsinger. He's got to cover sideline to sideline. He's basically man on with Shipley, following him wherever he goes.
Second down, goal to go for the Sobos. Shipley out of that deep shotgun, looking to throw, near side, pass is incomplete, and the penalty flag is coming in. Pass interference is going to be called, and it is going to be a half the distance penalty and an automatic first down for the Sobos.
Yeah, this is a good route here. Why was that Listenby on
Jazz.
The outside? Jazz Listenby, I believe. Shipley does a nice job throwing it low and hard and outside. As you see Isaac Hill come in there, he's dragging that right arm across the back, and that's going to be called every time.
So they're going to mark the ball.
Interference, half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
First down at the 3-yard line. For those of you who might not watch high school football all the time, pass interference, not a spot foul like it is in college in the NFL. It's just a 15-yard penalty with an automatic first down. Back to their short yardage set are the Sobos. It's going to be Goldsworthy bullying forward. He's close, and he is going to be what?
He's
is
in.
Is he in? No word yet from the officials. They're sorting things out. Touchdown. Touchdown for the Sobos. They're now up 28-14.
Well, there was such a mass of red there in the end zone, they couldn't tell which guy had the football, as Goldsworthy did have it. What a great push by that offensive line. As you see Coach Potthoff being thrown off the field right there by one of his assistants, very excited about that touchdown. Once again, they'll go for two here, Jim.
In the playoffs, that's Goldsworthy's 6th rushing touchdown in the playoffs.
Power eye formation one more time.
Going for two. Guess who? Goldsworthy goes in untouched. The 2-point conversion is good. 58 seconds to play in the third quarter. It is now South Beloit 30 and El Paso 14, but there was a penalty flag on the play. Hold everything, we might have to do this again. The officials sorting things out right now. Goldsworthy went in untouched for the conversion, but a penalty flag came in. So you see Drew Potthoff, the coach for South Beloit, wondering what's going on, and here's the word from John McAvoy.
The 2-point conversion is good. We have a dead ball, personal foul against South Beloit. 15-yard penalty will be assessed on the kickoff.
So South Beloit will have to kick off from its own 25-yard line.
Those are penalties that drive a coach crazy, as you see Coach Drew Potthoff not very happy about that. We're going to get a chance to see the touchdown one more time. Watch the offensive line surge here, Jim. Just everybody knocking people backwards. And when you got a guy like Goldsworthy, you can run people over. Big horse like he is, gets into the end zone.
Goldsworthy, 6'1", 200-pound senior.
He plays a lot bigger. You know, some guys play bigger. He plays bigger than 200 pounds.
Remember, Goldsworthy was our defensive key player of the game for South Beloit, now making an impact here on offense for the Sobos. Everybody loves to play offense in South Beloit.
Yeah, exactly. I thought that was great when you and I spoke earlier in the week that you tell, I hadn't done my homework yet on South Beloit. He said, Steve, you said, Steve, they don't have anybody listed at running back. You know, you got to be crazy. I've been in this game a long time, as there you see the scoring drive, but that's got to be fun for these players. And it really has created a lot of excitement. And when Kirk Pegler was talking to the cheerleaders that down there at halftime, you can just tell what's happening in South Beloit. But you know what? It's all based on winning. When you're winning, everybody's happy. Yeah. So
right now, let's go down to the field. Kurt Pegler is standing by. Kurt, what do you have for us?
Hey, Jim and Steve, the El Paso Comets might be poised to be making a quarterback change here. Kyle Sigler, who's got such a tender ankle, there was a doubt that he could even play today, is the backup quarterback, but they've had to go to their third stringer in Isaac Hill, who took a crash course in quarterbacking, as we all know, this week. But just moments ago, Sigler was warming up on the sidelines, and he could come in and play this quarter. We'll see. He's number two for El Paso.
All right. So El Paso might have to throw with the wind in the fourth quarter, and Sigler might be the guy to do it. Here's the kick. And on the return for El Paso, looking for running room across the 40. Is that Isaac Hill? Yes, it is. He's into South Beloit territory, and he will not go down until he gets inside the 45 to around the 44-yard line. Isaac Hill with a 25-yard kickoff return.
Boy, he ran about 100 yards. He ran all the way across the field, at least 53 yards. So nice play by him. And let's see if El Paso here with 47 seconds left to go in the third quarter can get something going, as we are going to have a quarterback change. As you see Isaac Hill coming off the field, changing his shoe. Let's see who the quarterback is.
It is Kyle Sigler, wearing number two. Sigler, the normal backup quarterback. Again, Jesse Smith is out with a broken arm that he suffered in the semifinals. Hunsinger with the carry up the middle to the 40. That is his 34th carry of the game, tying the Class 1A state championship game record for carries in a game. A 5-yard pickup for Hunsinger. Second and 5 upcoming for the Comets with just 27 seconds to play in the third quarter. South Beloit breaking open a game that was tied 14-14 at halftime with a couple of touchdowns and 2 2-point conversions. Hunsinger lowers his head, moves the pile. He's going to have a first down, and that'll be first down number 13 for El Paso. That might be the final play of the third quarter. They'll move the sticks and then wind the clock, and I don't think El Paso will try to another run. Will try to run another play here.
No, they definitely won't have to, and they'll go into the fourth quarter with the wind at their back, chance to throw the ball a little bit more.
As they come up to the line of scrimmage, they might get a playoff. Clock down to 3 seconds, 2 seconds, and they will get it off. Hunsinger with the carry, surges forward, and he gets to about the 26 before he's dropped, and that will be the final play of the third quarter. We're through three here in the Class 1A State Championship game. South Beloit with the lead, 30-14. We're back to Memorial Stadium after this local timeout. South Beloit with the football, or rather El Paso with the football. South Beloit with the lead, as you see some happy South Beloit Sobo fans. Their team 12 minutes away from the school's first ever in any sport state championship.
That's great to see so many fans have come down here on the Thanksgiving Day weekend. Very busy weekend for everybody, but man, they brought a lot of fans with them.
There you see the score, 30-14, South Beloit. El Paso with the ball, second down and 3 as we start the fourth quarter deep inside of Sobo territory. Sigler, the quarterback on the keeper, carries to about the 20. That'll be another first down. Through three quarters, South Beloit leading 30-14 and outgaining El Paso 283-192. So Sigler in there at quarterback, replacing Isaac Hill, as El Paso has to rally here in the fourth quarter. They need 2 touchdowns and 2 2-point conversions out of their double tight, double wing offense. Hunsinger with his record-setting 37th carry of the game. The old record for carries in a 1A title game, 34. Hunsinger now with 37 carries here in the ballgame. He had 29 carries in the first half.
Exactly right. That number will end up somewhere in the mid-40s, I would imagine.
Second down and 6 upcoming. Hunsinger, yardage-wise, now up to 165.
I think he'd change in a lot of those yards for a touchdown right here. They need to get something on the board quickly.
Hunsinger, the fullback again. tough yardage up the middle inside the 15, around the 13 or 14 yard line. And a penalty flag came in on the play late.
Yeah, we're definitely going to have something dead ball here. It might be a personal foul.
And we have an injured Sobo down in the field as well. So we have an official timeout for the injury. They'll tend to that with 11:03 to play in the ball game. Boy, if El Paso could punch it in here, get the two-point conversion, I mean, we're looking at a ball game here in the fourth quarter.
Exactly. Looks like Brad Barron's number 62 down on the field.
All right, with 11:03 to go here in the fourth quarter of the ball game, let's go ahead and take a timeout. It's a network timeout here on the IHSA television network. On WJYS TV 62 in Chicago. Back to the action. During the timeout, the penalty flag was a personal foul on South Beloit. So it gives El Paso an automatic first down, first and goal at the 7 for the Comets. Sigler on the keeper, tries to fight forward, gets to about the 6. He's pushed back.
Boy, they tried a little quarterback trap right there with Sigler. Fake to the left-hand side to Hunzinger. But man, South Beloit really sealed that one off. And now it'll be second down from the 6-yard line. And
this drive was set up by the great kickoff return by Isaac Hill of 25 yards that set El Paso up inside of Sobo territory. Second and goal. They toss it to Hunsinger, trying to get to the outside. Goldsworthy would have none of that. Jason Goldsworthy got to Hunsinger about the same time that he got the ball.
Oh, what a great play by Goldsworthy. We talked so much about him coming in. 148 tackles coming in, 11 sacks. 58 of those tackles are solo. This one right here, he just adds to his solo total, Jim. That's a nice play by Jason Goldsworthy.
He came free unblocked as you saw him bolting through the line there. And now, third down goal to go from the South Beloit 10-yard line. This is a must-score situation here for the Comets. They've got two plays to get 10 yards. Sigler rolling to the near side. In trouble. He's sacked. Little throws him down back at the 17-yard line. Brian Little with the sack, and now it's going to be fourth and goal from a long way out.
Boy, great play right there by Brian Little, listed at 6'1", 180-pound senior outside linebacker, but against this double wing, he's actually up on the line of scrimmage. And you're going to see him from the left-hand side of your screen come into the play real quickly. Nice speed right there by the linebackers, able to get to Sigler and drop him for a loss.
Fourth down goal to go from the South Beloit 16-yard line. Sigler back to pass. Timing pattern into the end zone. The ball is going to be caught for the touchdown. What a grab by Chris Carr. Boy, blanket coverage from Jazz Listenby. Carr leaped up, made the catch, and what a play. Boy, oh boy, that is outstanding.
16 yards.
You know right there, you've got 6'3 on 5'6". Great call by El Paso. They knew by formation they'd get single man coverage right there. Good throw by Sigler and Chris Carr. I'll tell you, he's their man when they go to throw the football. Good look at Chris Carr right there in the back of the huddle.
So now a big two-point conversion attempt for the Comets. They need this one very badly. They'll go with double tights and double wings. Sigler takes. Running option to the near side. He's going to go in untouched. He wasn't touched till he got into the end zone. The two-point conversion is good. And folks, with 8:56 to go in the quarter, we have got a ball game. It's 30-22 in favor of South Beloit.
The referees are down there conversing about something. There may have been a late flag on the play, Jim.
There is a flag. There was a penalty call. I don't see where the flag is at now.
It almost looked like there was a late hit by Listenby on Sigler, the quarterback.
That might be the call. Let's hear from Mr. McAvoy.
The two-point conversion was good. We have an inadvertent face mask. 5-yard penalty will be assessed on the kickoff.
So there you have the penalty call. The two-point conversion is good. And let's watch Chris Carr making this stupendous play once again.
Yeah, I love the play call, no doubt about it. You're going to see Chris Carr at the top of the screen. And Sigler does a nice job just tossing that one up. And you got a guy 6'3", just go up, let him make a play. You always talk about having playmakers. As Chris Carr pulls in this 16-yard touchdown, Might have gotten away with a little bit of a push off there, but nice catch and nice throw again.
Carr with his 24th catch of the year, his sixth touchdown for his career at South Beloit. He now has 82 receptions. Prior to this year, he's a three-year starter, right. But most of the time before this year, he was a split end. This year, with Hunsiger being able to run the ball, they called on Carr to come in and be a tight end and be a run-blocking tight end. And he, as a team player, stepped forward, exactly. Said, no problem, coach, I'll do that. His receiving numbers aren't quite as high as they have been, but boy, was that could be a season-saving play right there for
exactly.
El Paso.
You know, Mike Serrata made a point of telling you and I about that, showing how unselfish all these players are for El Paso. That they'll go with a different offensive scheme if it gets us into the state championship. That's what it did here this year, but now they're still trailing by 8 with 8:56 left in the fourth quarter.
Brandon Duffy with a kick. It's a squibber rolling along the ground and finally fielded by Joe Sager deep inside of his own territory and trying to come to the near side. He's got running room. He is to the 30. He's got running room off the right sideline. He's not going to be pushed out of bounds until he gets right to midfield. What a great return of 39 yards by number 17, Joe Sager.
Boy, El Paso kicks the football exactly where South Beloit wants him to. You can see there's a whole wall, all these red guys right along here, and they're able to get outside of it and up the field. And I'll tell you, there's a touchdown saving tackle right here at the end of the play. I didn't get the number of the player, but you can see the speed once again. And we've talked about that, and one of our keys was speed kills. And I'll tell you what, they've shown a lot of it.
You know what, Steve, you don't find many 1A football teams that have the speed across the board that South Beloit does so many different guys.
Usually you get one or two, you know, something like that. Maybe your quarterback or running back, even a wideout. But I mean, they've got five or six guys that have a lot of speed and are playmakers for them. But, you know, that's by design. That's what they want to do here with this offensive formation as we got Dewan Listenby back in the backfield.
He gets the short snap. He's into El Paso territory, breaking tackles to the 40, close to the first down before he's pushed back. And I think he might have been a little bit short of the first down. Second down and short coming up.
Got a nice block right there from Jazz Listenby, brother down the field. As I think El Paso's going to have to take some chances right now defensively. Down 8. I know you're still in the football game, but they've got to find a way to stop that running play. That running play has been very effective here in the second half.
Listenby with 8 carries for 59 yards running that play right there.
That's exactly right.
Second down and very short here for the Sobos. Ball is at the El Paso 40-yard line. South Beloit working against the wind. Again, it is Dewan Listenby with the short snap, breaking tackles, and he's going to be down to about the 32. It's a first down for the Sobos. South Beloit's 18th first down of the game. El Paso has 15.
You know, that's the other wrinkle they throw in there off of that quick snap to Dewan Listenby. You know, a lot of times he's coming up the middle. That one, he takes the ball and goes directly to the sideline. And I like the wrinkles that you're able to show from this offense. Nice scheme.
Dewan Listenby with a 10-yard run for the first down there. And the ball is now at the 31-yard line inside of El Paso territory. Four receivers. And again, it is Dewan Listenby. Bounces to the outside. Breaks a tackle at the line of scrimmage and surges forward up the left sideline for a pickup of around 5 yards.
This is one you don't see very often, a missed tackle by Derek Hunsinger. He actually had a chance to stop Dewan Listenby for about a 2-yard gain. He missed the tackle. Listenby picked up a couple more yards. You're going to see it here on a replay. Short snap once again. Dewan Listenby just kind of pick a hole right there as Hunsinger comes up from his linebacker position. This time he's able to get out of his arms and pick up a couple extra yards.
Second down and 5. Again, this time it's Shipley throwing far sideline, and the pass is going to be called incomplete. Nice attempt by Little. Brian Little trying to come up with it, and it's going to be third down at 5. The clock stops with 7:23 left to go. Derek Hunsinger with 164 yards rushing. That is more than Dewan Listenby and Jared Shipley combined. They've combined for 134. But if you look at the numbers for South Beloit, they've rushed for 142, and they've only passed for 164. Shipley wants to throw, rolling near side, and he is going to be sacked.
Well, we haven't called Kyle Feaster's name hear much in the second half, but right there, they're able to get to the quarterback and drop Shipley for a big loss.
So now it's going to be fourth down and about 13 as we'll see a replay of this big defensive effort for the Comets.
See Shipley working his way upfield, just manhandling the center right there as Feaster just hangs on for dear life as his partners come along and drag Shipley to the ground.
Andrew Gilliland came in to clean up the mess, and you're right, Feaster was hanging on for dear life. Mr. Shipley, you're not getting away this time. Fourth down and 14 for the Sobos. They're 1-for-1 on fourth down in the game. Shipley rolling to the near side. He airs it out. Pass is going to be caught. Close to a first down around the 20-yard line. And it is going to be a first down for the Sobos. Dunkel making the catch. It's a pickup of about 15 yards and a first down. What a great throw. What a great catch.
Oh, it is. If we get a chance to see the hit that Derek Hunzinger puts on the quarterback, I mean, he just drills Shipley. But right before that, Shipley drills the ball in. I believe that was Dunkel catching the ball. You see the hit right there of Hunzinger. Dunkel does a good job. You can tell he's an experienced receiver. Gets past the first down markers, and they're able to pick it up. Now they have first down from the 20-yard line.
It was fourth and 14, right, and they picked up 16 yards.
That's experience.
Inside the 20, first down for the Sobos. And we're going to get a whistle and a penalty. The play clock was, and we're going to get a procedure penalty more than likely upcoming on South Beloit. 6:28 to play in the game. South Beloit leading 30-22 here in the Class 1A state title game.
We have a dead ball, snap infraction on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down. Reset the game clock to 6:29.
See, a snap violation. Would that be the center just snapping the ball too soon?
Yeah, he might have done that, or he bumped it forward a little bit. Sometimes those centers tend to roll that ball if the seams aren't exactly where they want, and sometimes they let you get away with it, sometimes they don't.
So first and 15 for the Sobos. Shipley throwing near side, pass caught. It is Dunkel, his sixth catch of the game, breaking tackles. He's got a first down inside the 10 to around the 8-yard line. Jacob Dunkel with another catch for the Sobos.
Well, his size right here helps him. 6'6", 200 pounds. He's just able to run through some of the tackles. As once again, Shipley, he's looking to where he's going to throw this football right away. Dunkel does a great job using that arm as a third leg, keeping his balance, picking up another first down.
Jared Shipley has completed 14 passes, 6 of them to his first cousin, Jacob Dunkel. Brad Baker is also a first cousin to Shipley and Dunkel. Goldsworthy with a carry, off right tackle, not much. Second down goal to go coming up for the Sobos. This is where the El Paso defense, if they want to have an opportunity in the final 6 minutes of this ball game, they have to make a stand right here.
Yep, exactly. They can't let them put any points on the board, or it's going to be very difficult with hardly a passing offense to come back.
So here comes South Beloit up to the line of scrimmage. In these short yarded situations, they don't go no huddle. They huddle up and come up to the line, and they'll go with that power eye.
Taking their time, no doubt about it.
Goldsworthy, the eye, with a couple of offensive linemen in front of him. Shipley on play action, looking to throw, flushed out, throws into the end zone. Great defensive play. And they're going to call pass interference on Chris Carr. Carr defending against Dunkel.
You see Chris Carr there with his hands up in the air. I don't think he's very happy about that. The back judge actually throws the flag. The side judge, or the judge here in the corner, did not throw the flag. Tough play.
Pass interference on El Paso is the call. Wow. That's a big one, automatic first down.
Yeah, a lot of times the official can't, one official can't see the arm wrapped around the receiver. Something must have happened because the official called it.
So it's a first down for South Beloit at the El Paso 4. It would have been third down if the incompletion would have stood. So South Beloit will stay in their short yardage formation, the power eye, and they give it up the middle. Sager, and he's going to go in for the touchdown. Staver with a touchdown, and it's now 36-22. Staver is normally a guard. That's his 10th rushing touchdown of the year.
That's right. Yes, folks, that was number 68. I mean, you look at him, he's in there in the backfield, 5'6", 200 pounds, and a senior, just lowers that shoulder and running people over.
So now South Beloit will go for two. They go power eye, strength left. Now we've got penalty flags, and South Beloit must have jumped. 5:18 to go in the ball game. It's now 36-22, South Beloit.
We're still on the try.
So now South Beloit will try for the conversion from the 8-yard line instead of the 3 after the 5-yard walk-off.
That actually helps them. Kind of lengthens the field a little bit, gives them more room to throw the football. As you see new players coming in, I think they're going to go back to their wide open offense.
Coming up after this ball game, we'll have the 4A state title game, a rematch of last year's overtime classic between Mount Carmel and Driscoll. Stay tuned for that. Throw into the end zone for the 2-point conversion over the head of Dunkel, incomplete. And to throw it over Dunkel, you've got to throw it pretty high. So the 2-point conversion is no good.
Chris Carr breaks up the extra point attempt with 5:18 remaining in the game at South Beloit.
Here is the rushing touchdown for South Beloit moments ago to put them up by 14 points.
See the offensive line surge here by South Beloit. Everybody just pushing forward, and Staver just running people over, does a great job. It's hard to draw up anything right there. It's just everybody straight ahead, knock your man backwards.
9-play, 50-yard scoring drive, and right now let's head down to the field here at Memorial Stadium where Kurt Pegler is standing by. Kurt.
Well, Jim and Steve, when they stack that, bring all those guys, and they call that the cement line because of the rock quarries up in the South Beloit area. They said that the cement industry is the big industry there. They call that the cement line on short yardage, where they put all those stocky guys in there and run it right up the gut.
All right, thank you, Kurt. And that would be a good way to describe Staver. Stocky, 6 foot, 200 pounds. On the return, it's Isaac Hill for South Beloit, looking for running room, and he's out across the 35 to about the 37. The ball came loose, and El Paso coughs it up, and it was Staver recovering the fumble, and he carries down around the 20-yard line. So South Beloit gets it right back, and Staver having the time of his life right now.
Another turnover. Unbelievable. Staver did a great job. That just happened so quickly that we almost missed that one. We're going to see Isaac Hill right there, and watch Staver, number 68, come in here late, and this is just great coaching. Look at him yanking away at that football, and Staver's trying to score another touchdown after that play.
Well, South Beloit moves into a new high school on Monday, as we heard Kurt Pegler tell you earlier, and boy, there might be a nice piece of trophy, a nice piece of decoration to bring to that new high school on Monday. Dewan Listenby with the carry for the Sobos.
Boy, wouldn't that be a great way to christen a new high school, bring in a state championship, first state championship ever in any sport to your new high school. I tell you, that place will be up for grabs.
South Beloit's only loss this season was a non-conference game to Poplar Grove North Boone, 30-27 back in week 4. In week 9, in the conference matchup between those two teams, South Beloit won 27-6. And it was in that game where South Beloit thought, hey, we might be able to do something here. That was the first time in 15 tries that they'd beaten their conference rival, North Boone. A loss on this carry to bring up a third down. Staver was the ball carrier again for the Sobos. Hunziker made the tackle. We're approaching the 4-minute mark of the fourth quarter. South Beloit with the ball in control, leading 36-22.
Boy, that clock just continues to run right here. I would imagine they'll stay with that big backfield, just turn around and hand it to Goldsworthy, Staver, maybe Dewan Listenby. Got to keep it on the ground right here.
Third down and 9. Ball is at the 20-yard line in El Paso territory. Shipley throwing. Far side, Little makes the catch at the 5, touchdown. The touchdown reception of 20 yards. It's 42-22, South Beloit.
Man, just when you think they got to run the clock, I'm sitting there bragging about how they're going to eat the clock up. They throw a rocket out to the left-hand side. Little does a great job. Little out route on the outside. The ball is put right on the spot by Jared Shipley.
Shipley with his fourth touchdown pass of the game. in his 45th of the season. They're going to kick the conversion. It's Dunkel with the kick. It sails to the uprights, and it is good. 3:29 left to play here in the fourth quarter. It is now 43-22 in favor of South Beloit.
Okay, replay right here in Shipley, ground level. You see the rocket he throws out to the left is Little.
Attention, please.
A nice little route, isolated one-on-one, able to get in.
Clyde Leonard,
take another look at
Mount Carmel.
End zone camera.
Please report to the
That's a tough throw. That's not as easy as it looks right there, folks. That's a high school kid throwing that football.
Little with his eighth touchdown reception of the year. And well, what a season this has been for Jared Shipley. In the game today, 15 of 28 for 216 yards, four touchdowns, two interceptions. Coming in, the 3,632 yards passing that Shipley had, the third best ever season in the state of Illinois in passing. The record set by Tim Brazek last year with 46-44. He now has 45 touchdown passes this season. For his career, he has 87 touchdown passes, which is also third best all time.
Those are some staggering numbers. I'm telling you what, it's amazing. There you see the scoring drive of South Beloit.
South Beloit has had a 20-yard scoring drive, a 21-yard scoring drive, and a 23-yard scoring drive today after El Paso turnovers.
That's exactly right.
Squib kick from Dunkel. Bobbled by Hill. He picks it up at about the 17. Hill on the run to the 30. Look out. He's to midfield. Hill into South Beloit territory. And they're going to mark him out around the 40-yard line. Solid return for Isaac Hill of 40 yards.
Boy, I think we got to give Isaac Hill a ton of credit, don't we? I mean, forced into the role of starting quarterback. We're going to see the replay right here as he's going to get to the wedge after fumbling the football around, but shows nice speed, gets upfield, just trying to make plays. He knows he's playing in his last football game as a high school player. Takes a nice little pop there at the end of the play, too.
So Sigler is still in there at quarterback. I formation backfield. Hunsinger with his 40th carry of the game.
Now you got to speed things up a little bit, go to a little bit of two-minute offense or something. It's not something I'm sure that El Paso's had to practice a lot this year, but they got to get in and out of that huddle very quickly.
Credit El Paso here for a gutsy effort. It was 14 all at halftime. They were playing with their third string quarterback in Isaac Hill after their starters were hurt. Now Sigler as the backup has come back in, but he's playing hurt, but gutsy effort for the Comets, but they're gonna come up short tonight as Sigler is dropped.
Boy,
the ball loose and it's gonna go for a touchdown. The ball is gonna be called a fumble. Brian Little picks it up and sashays into the end zone for a touchdown. That is the 12th defensive touchdown that South Beloit has scored this year, a 54-yard fumble return for Brian Little. 12 defensive touchdowns.
That's amazing. And you could just hear a pin drop after he fumbled that football. And the, you know, the whistle didn't blow. We kept waiting. I've got headphones on, and I couldn't hear a whistle. And Brian Little just scampered down the left side of the field there. Boy, to give a 49-22 lead now here with 2:36 left.
But Little, he picked up the ball, and he's kind of like, Can I run?
Excuse me, sir.
Run, okay. And then he's into the end zone for the 54-yard fumble return. Dunkel again for the conversion. The kick on the way to the uprights, and the kick is good. 50-22 South Beloit.
Let's see what the replay shows us here on this play. As Sigler is going to go back to pass, going to take a big hit. He's trying to throw the ball here on the outside to Chris Carr. You see the pressure there on Sigler. Look at everybody stop, even the El Paso players stop, and the coaches from El Paso yelling, you got to tackle him, the ball's still alive, and Little just runs untouched for 54 yards in the touchdown.
So 2:36 left to go. There you see Brian Little celebrating his 54-yard fumble return for the touchdown. South Beloit pouring it on here in the second half. At halftime, we were tied up 14 all. And now it's 50-22, South Beloit. If anybody doubted as to whether or not the Sobos were for real with their, you know, gimmicky offense, right, you might say, they are.
Well, everybody says at the end of the year you got to be able to run the football. You know, they've run the football effectively today, but that's not their base offense. They come in and want to throw it. They've mixed it up nicely today, and it has worked.
South Beloit has actually run 31 times and passed 28 times, so they've had great balance.
That's unbelievable. I didn't think they'd run the football that much, but obviously their coaches did their homework, studied El Paso's game film, and thought they could run the football.
216 yards passing for the Sobos here this afternoon and 138 yards rushing.
It's good balance, no doubt about it.
So now the Sobos to kick it off again. Still 236 left to go here in quarter number four. Here's the return for the Comets. That is Petta on the return to the 38 before he's finally bumped down. A 19-yard return for Joe Petta. South Beloit with a flurry of offense and defense here in the second half of the ballgame. I think that a lot of times South Beloit has so much offensive firepower, but their defense gets kind of overshadowed. But we told you earlier that they force turnovers. They're what you would call a big play defense. They're looking to hit the home run on defense a lot.
Why not? Exactly. They've got the players to make the plays, and obviously it's worked for them this year.
A carry up the middle again for Hunsinger. Got a couple before he was pushed back, and boy, Derek Hunsinger, there's nobody more disappointed in what is going on in the field right now than Derek Hunsinger.
No, that's his 40th carry of the afternoon, 166 yards. He does have that touchdown, but I'll tell you, he's going to be worn out at the end of this football game.
He certainly is, and then he'll get ready for the wrestling season.
Yeah.
Hunsinger, the reigning 171-pound champion in Class A wrestling.
Boy, that's a brutal category to be in, too. You know, 171, you got guys cutting from 180, 190 coming down there. Just tells you what kind of athlete he is.
They toss it to Petta, near side, tries to stiff arm McCluskey, and McCluskey rides him out of bounds. 1:40 to go, clock ticking. Here in the fourth quarter, South Beloit is going to win its first ever state championship in any sport. South Beloit, located on the Illinois-Wisconsin border, just a little bit north of Rockford. And the Sobos are going to be celebrating here in about 90 seconds.
That is going to be a fun bus trip back to South Beloit. About a four-hour trip, as Coach Potthoff told us. And they will have a lot of fun on that bus.
South Beloit, 0-9 in 1994. 0-9 in 1999. And now they're going to be state champs. Here's a deep pass down the field. The ball is going to be incomplete, intended for Carr. He was bobbling it as he was tiptoeing along the right sideline. DeJuan Listenby on the coverage for for South Beloit.
Get a chance to see a replay one more time as El Paso goes back into the I formation. Sigler, I'll give him a lot of credit. He's really got that banged up ankle. It's hard to push off on that left ankle that he has, and Chris Carr almost makes a phenomenal catch there at the end, but DeJuan Listenby knocks it away. They are disciplined. I'll tell you, I am very impressed by South Beloit's discipline, both on offense and defense. They run exactly what the coaches tell them to.
Fourth down and six here for El Paso. They run it to Petta on a counter. Petta fighting forward, close to first down yardage. It'll be close. They'll stop the clock here to take a look, and there's a penalty flag that came in on the play. Penalty flag on the play as well. With 54 seconds to go in the ball game, and let's see what the call is going to be here as darkness starts to fall here in Champaign. Personal foul against El Paso.
Good look right there. Mike Serrata and his coaching staff, they've done a wonderful job this year going undefeated through the regular season and here through the playoffs. Great job with this group of seniors and the other kids that he's put together on this football team.
You know, you have to get some breaks to win a title.
No doubt about it.
And I'm sure Coach Serrata and his staff are asking the what if Jesse Smith didn't break his arm? They're starting quarterback in the semifinals last week. And I mean, you don't know, but I'm sure that a lot of El Paso coaches and players and fans are going to be asking that what if. But you know what? Even if Smith played, El Paso would have had to play very well to beat South Beloit.
No doubt about it. And that's Coach Mike Serrata and his staff. They're not going to talk about that. They're not going to make excuses for what happened.
We had a dead ball, personal foul against the white, 15 yards from the end of the run. It'll be first and 10.
So just 54 seconds left. El Paso will keep the ball. It'll be first and 10, but they're marched all the way back to their own 34-yard line.
Boy, what a feeling for some of these seniors for South Beloit. Jason Goldsworthy, Brad Baker, Brian Little, David Bennington. You got quite a few of them there. Justin Stavers got a touchdown or two this afternoon. It's been just unbelievable. Rich Rowlett. I mean, there's quite a few seniors on this South Beloit team, and man, they deserve a lot of credit.
South Beloit had one playoff victory in their history prior to this year. That came in the first round last year, and they're gonna rattle off five wins and get a state championship in this season. Here's the carry for El Paso out across the 35 to around the 38 before the ball carrier is brought down. Isaac Hill with the carry. Remember, he started the game at quarterback.
Right.
And his normal position was wing back, and you know, what a gutsy effort for him. He made some mistakes today, but he made some plays as well.
He sure did.
It was his kickoff return that set up El Paso's only touchdown of the second half. Clock rolling with 20 seconds to go. There you see it in the upper portion of your screen. Why not give it to Hunsinger one more time?
Might as well.
Derek carries into South Beloit territory to about the 48-yard line. They'll stop the clock to move the chains. That might be the final play of the game. I'm not sure if El Paso will try to run another play or not. Just 9 seconds left to go.
You know, we talked to Drew Potthoff right before the game started. I asked him, you know, do you got any basketball players on your team? Because it is time for that season. Most of them play, so, you know, yeah, they'll jump right into basketball, but they're going to savor this victory, no doubt about it.
The clock working down to zero, and 3 years after going 0-9, South Beloit is state champion.
Wow, what a feeling for all those kids. I tell you, look at them running on the field, and they are just very excited, as you see Dick Boros right there, the defensive coordinator from El Paso, coming over and congratulating Drew Potthoff on a wonderful season for these South Beloit Sobos.
South Beloit went 0-9 in 1994, 1-8 in 1995, 1-8 in 1997. In 99, 0-9, 3-6 in the year 2000, 7-4 last year, 13-1.
Wow.
And state champions this year. Now, this is a very, very special group of senior athletes for South Beloit. Now, this team was actually about as potential state contenders when they were in middle school. They saw this coming a long time down the road. And it was in Drew Potthoff's first year at South Beloit back in 1997 that people started to whisper in his ear, you know, we got a pretty special group down in the middle school level, that they're really athletic and they really like to get after it in the football field. And, you know, lo and behold, a few years later, they're dancing here on the turf at Memorial Stadium as state champs. Right now here, let's go down to the field where Kurt Pegler is standing by with victorious South Beloit coach Drew Potthoff.
All right, thank you, guys. Yeah, Drew Potthoff, the head coach of the state champion Sobos. You know, everybody talked about your offense, your offense, your offense, but it was your defense in the second half that made the difference.
That's why we said at the beginning of the year, that's why we gave those T-shirts out, that offense sells tickets. We got a lot of flash there. But defense wins championships, and they proved it here today. We stopped them in the second half. We came up big. They gave the offense the ball. And when they gave the offense the ball, we got it in the end zone. And the special teams picked up big. And just did a heck of a job. Just did a heck of a job.
And Jared Shipley sure did make everybody pay for those turnovers.
Yes, he did. And he's a great one. And give the receivers and just everybody gets credit. The coaches, you know, it's just such a fantastic feeling. It's just such a fantastic feeling. You know, it was a heck of a first half. They were giving us fits, and we got settled down and just played a great second half. I'm numb. I don't know what to say.
Well, let me ask you about this. I know 3 years ago you were 0-9. Next week you move into a new high school and you're going to have a state championship trophy to kind of christen the place. That's got to be a nice thing.
That's one heck of a centerpiece. It's going to be fantastic. I'm so happy for our kids. I'm so happy for our community. It's been a long time coming and well-deserved. And a great football team we played today. You know, give El Paso a lot of credit. You know, they just came after us and came after us and came after us. And that Hunsinger is just one heck of a running back. And we just, the ball bounced our way, thank God, in the second half.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
All right, that's Drew Potthoff, the head coach of the state champion South Beloit Sobos. As you guys have mentioned, the first ever state champion in any sport in that school's history. Guys.
All right, your final here, South Beloit 50 and El Paso 22. South Beloit, your 1A state champs. Let's take a break. It's a network timeout on the IHSA television network. South Beloit outscoring El Paso 36-8 in the second half. The ball game was tied up 14-14 at halftime, and the Sobos win their first ever state championship. Going away, as you see El Paso on the podium right now, accepting their second place trophy, El Paso's best ever finish in football, and a gutsy effort from the Comets, shorthanded, injury-riddled, and they hung with the South Beloit. Until the early stages of the fourth quarter, this was still a ball game.
Exactly, and who better to take that trophy as the two captains, as you see Kyle Feaster there, Derek Hunsinger, number 30, was also on that podium with him. And congratulations to Mike Serrata and the whole coaching staff and the players and fans for the El Paso Comets.
Offense sells tickets, defense wins championships. That has been the mantra for South Beloit all season. Today, South Beloit forces five El Paso fumbles. That means, this is just amazing, South Beloit forced 60 turnovers this season, and they were plus 45 in turnover differential for the season. That's just an amazing stat.
Well, we talked about it, and that's why they're standing up here on the championship podium right now, going to receive their medals as well as the trophy.
There you see Jason Goldsworthy.
Four captains right there.
DeWine Listenby just took his medal, and Jared Shipley. Shipley with 216 more yards passing and four touchdowns today, over 7,000 yards passing in his career at South Beloit.
As they get to raise that championship trophy to the sky, we knew they were a confident bunch coming in. We talked to the coach. They didn't even schedule a Thanksgiving Day basketball tournament. A lot of these players play. They knew they were going to be in this football game at the beginning of the season, and they are, and they won it, and they deserve to be the Class 1A state champions.
They look back to last year in the second round loss to Kewanee Weathersfield. Weathersfield, of course, went on to win the state championship, and South Beloit felt, they had an opportunity to win that game, and they used that as motivation for this year. This year, they beat Weathersfield in the semifinals, and now South Beloit is your state champion. As you look at some of the final numbers here, look at the rushing yards for South Beloit, 138 yards rushing.
It doesn't sound like a whole lot, but when you're a passing team, that jumps out at you, and we could really circle the one right down there, the turnovers, and that really was a telling tale for the El Paso Comets, and pretty clean played game. Not a whole lot of penalties. Beloit did commit a couple there at the end of the game, ends up with 9 penalties, but they will take the 50-22 win, no doubt about that.
Total yards, 354-233 in favor of South Beloit. There you see third downs and some of the other statistics. The rushing number, look at that, 62 rushing attempts for El Paso. That is a new Class 1A record. Breaks the old record of 58 set by Carthage in the year 2000. And solid rushing numbers for South Beloit, as we said as well. And now let's look at some of the highlights of this South Beloit victory. As you see, some of the Sobos heading to the locker room.
Well, there were quite a few of them, and all started with this man right here, Jared Shipley, the quarterback. And he made the throws when he had to. And I'll tell you, they are just one tough offense, and they were very tough to stop, as that was right there, Goldsworthy sneaking in the end zone for one of his touchdowns this afternoon. Some of the highlights for the El Paso Comets were throwing the football to Chris Carr. Chris goes up and makes a big catch right here, but it just wasn't enough, as South Beloit was just too much for him this afternoon.
Remember, at one point it was 30-22 in the fourth quarter. There's another touchdown catch, this one from Brian Little, up the left sideline into the end zone.
Boy, he stepped up there in the fourth quarter, didn't he, right here. And this is really one of the telling touchdowns for South Beloit, as Staver just running people over, gets in the end zone again. See Drew Potthoff getting the handshake from the official right there.
It would be a thrill for a lineman to score any touchdown.
Right.
Staver, as a lineman, he got to score 10 this year.
Man, that's fun. Well, he makes it exciting. You see Potthoff raising the trophy there, and it makes it fun for everybody.
Once again, your final here in the Class 1A State Championship game from Memorial Stadium in Champaign, South Beloit 50 and El Paso 22. Let's pause for a local timeout.